Howard 101 presents The Jay Thomas Show. Call 888-STERN-101. The Jay Thomas Show. This is The Jay Thomas Show on Howard 101.
Show at Howard 101. Madison is here. Shuley will arrive when Shuley arrives. Luckiest guy in show business. We had a great time last night at Caroline's. That's right. I almost forgot again. But it was a great thanks for everybody that was listening and came out. And we did a bit on Howard yesterday and talked about it. And it was fun, and we had Twitchell's, the Tourette's comic, on, you know. And then afterward, we go to dinner with him, and he's, you know, got Tourette's. And before I introduced him, I said, you know, we have a comedian coming up here who suffers from Tourette's. It's okay to laugh. That's what he said I had to say. And then we go to dinner, and, man, I couldn't stop thinking about.
And then he drank a soda.
That's all he can drink is a soda.
Well, I thought, I said to him, don't get a soda. It'll make you more twitchy.
No, you can't have any booze, nothing. Nothing.
He could have had a water.
Why wouldn't you give him, you mean it would have jacked his ass up?
Yeah. I'm just saying it made him a little more spazzy, a little more hyper.
Yeah, you know, and Shuley, I was thinking that you introduced me to Twitchell's, the Tourette's comedian.
The Tourette's filled comedian.
And we went to dinner with him, you know.
He's a sweet kid, huh?
He's so really sweet, but that.
Yeah. I said to Jay when he went to the bathroom, I said, do you think he can fucking stop twitching?
She liked him if he could only stop twitching.
You got to hear, you know, every Sunday I do Miserable Men with him and Levy, and they live near each other. So Levy picks him up and they drive in together. I have a voicemail from Levy flipping out. He's in the back seat while Levy's leaving me a message, and you just hear him. And Levy's going, yeah, we got to get him a different way to get out here. He goes, I don't know if I could handle it. He says it's like having a loose cat in the back seat.
Well, Levy, God bless him. He's, yeah. You know, he takes care of Beetlejuice. He takes care of Tourette's guy.
Listen to
he
this.
He takes care of everyone. Oh, what fun. Who's this?
This is Twitchell doing Jingle Bells.
Sleigh, jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle
bells. Who's singing?
Twitchell.
He's got a good voice.
Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh, dashing through the snow in a one-horse open sleigh. Ah, all the fields we go, laughing all the way. Bells and bobtail ring, making spirits bright. Oh, what fun it is to laugh and sing in a sleighing song tonight. Ah, day or two ago, I thought I'd take a ride. And soon Miss Fanny Bright was seated by my side. Yeah. The horse was lean and lank, lean and lank. Misfortune seemed his lot. We got into a drifted bank, and then we got upside. Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way.
Oh, my God.
Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. Hey, yeah. Jingle bells, jingle away. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. Dashing through.
Hey, listen, this is where he screws up. Listen.
Sleigh. Oh, wait. I think I'm. I get. No, let's make it happen anyway. bells, a bobtail ring, spirits bright. Oh, what fun it is to laugh and sing on a sling song.
Oh,
I can do it better, I swear.
Wow.
Oh. Bravo.
My kids went on YouTube last night, and is this on YouTube?
I don't think so. God. I don't know if anybody was filming. I don't think anybody other than Caroline's allowed to film and post stuff up on YouTube. Caroline's put it up.
They ought to just put it on as an audio. I mean,
What I'm thinking, you know, since it was such a... And can I just say what a fantastic job you did last night?
Yeah.
I am so...
Thank you.
You almost gave me a panic attack before the show because you were so nervous and...
Right.
And I never had to, like, actually produce a comedy show like I did last night.
Well, first of all, I turned it over to you because people were asking me questions, and I said, look, I didn't stop doing stand-up because it was a success, okay? I was a stand-up comedian, and I was getting just smashed, murdered.
Mm, right.
And no one got what I was doing, and I was telling jokes. I didn't tell any stories or whatever it was.
Right.
So I said, you know, I'm not, you know, doing this anymore, right? So... You know, I can MC things and have a booklet in my hand and make fun and do a roast and all of that. But I'll have my notes and there's a specific thing. But to walk up and own your own material. My wife said to me last night, she said, what are you doing?
Right.
She says, next time, why don't you just skydive? You know, like she says.
Not as frightening.
She's so supportive.
What do you need? Some challenge or something? I said, you know, actually it was an accident. Shuley got me into it, and I could have just gotten up and said, here's all these comics and done 2 minutes.
Right.
But, you know, I felt as though if you're going to get up at a comedy club, you do like 20 minutes.
Well, what you did as a host, not a lot of hosts do, and it was especially for a guy who hasn't done this in over 20 years, to go up and host and then do 20 minutes up front. Like 20, it's one thing to do 10 minutes. 5 minutes. You haven't done it in 20 years. That I can understand. But to be able to crank out 20 minutes and a good 20 minutes.
Yeah. It was fun.
It was great. And once you got over that hump, I was like, oh, this show's going to be great.
Well,
you needed to have your life experiences before you could do it again.
That's exactly right.
Well, so, the thing was,
he needed to have what he could talk about.
When he tells his stories, it's hilarious.
Yeah,
so that's all he had to do.
I talked about I called my mother-in-law.
That was my favorite part.
What happened was, I was nervous anyway, and I was angry that I was nervous.
Right.
So when I got, and so I'm having like a little panic attack, and it's all brand new material and all that. And so I'm thinking, man, if I get up there and fail, we'll have a lot of fun with it the next day. It'll be funny too.
And I was thinking the same thing. I'm like, what could go wrong that he's going to tear me apart Friday morning on the Air Force?
No, no. So,
no.
So I get in there, you know, and everybody is talking. I turn to Shuley. I said, man, look, you got to produce this thing or do something. I can't make any, decisions.
And it went from us having like 4 comics on the show to having 8.
Well,
how did you do that so quickly?
Well, the problem was when Rodney backed out, I tried to replace him with a couple female comedians, that Jay had requested.
Uh-huh.
We couldn't get a hold of them. But once I put in a call to Caroline's that I needed a couple more spots,
I see.
They filled in with their house guys.
I
like
that
really
Italian
good.
Guy.
Mike Vecchione.
I'd like to date him.
Which comic on the lineup would you not like to date? Let's narrow that list
I just
down.
Want the Italian.
And then there
well,
was
I
Julian
felt badly.
McCullough.
She really liked Twitchell's, and she turned to me and she said, you know, she said it before, but she meant it like, God, if he could only stop twitching. Because he was really, you know, good. Now
he's a sweetheart, though. He calls everyone dear. I mean, he's like, he's from the 40s.
Yeah.
Right. He's like, hiya, dear.
Operator, give me Lakewood, 759.
Yeah. So for those of you that weren't there last night, I started as a stand-up comic in high school at Jesuit High School in New Orleans. And so when I was 17 years old, I did a professional stand-up comedian bit for like 2 nights. And it made the papers, and I imitated like Bill Cosby and Woody Allen and all. But
so that was the beginning of your career.
But it was a big deal, and I was a kid. And so then I started doing nightclubs in the Quarter and stuff like that. And around the South and all, and then I stopped. Years later, I stopped doing it.
Did you ever have to get like special permission to play certain clubs?
No, when the cops came, I hit under the
New Orleans.
Well, because Bill Hicks
back in the 20s.
Hicks used to start. He started the same way. He needed a special permit to play in these bars in Austin.
That's like in a place that's normal in New Orleans.
Yeah.
I went into a strip
it's
club.
Depraved.
I was at the Bayou Room. There was a folk singer. A stripper.
Were you at that strip club Gumbo's?
No, I didn't go to Gumbo's. Gumbo's strip shop. I worked at the place where the girl was on the swing. You ever been in New Orleans?
Ooh.
And her legs go out of the...
yeah, classy.
That's real?
Not anymore. Now it's a, you know, it's a dummy. But when I was there, it was a real girl.
Wow.
And she would swing over the, you know, and her coos would be right over your...
The snapper swing.
Yeah, over your head. And guys would, like, come in there with umbrellas and shit, you know, so they didn't get wet.
How you doing today?
Yeah, yeah,
looking up. Talking to her vagina as it's swinging back and forth.
It'd be like a fly following her, you know.
Having a good night tonight. How about that weather, huh?
Yeah, and so, and what they would do is on the swing, they would slide their ass back.
Right.
Oh, people were going crazy. Oh.
Sure.
So I would, you know, be telling jokes and all that. So this one guy, you know, I played football, but I blocked for this guy and all. He was our big All-American quarterback in high school. And, of course, I wanted to be a quarterback. I didn't get to be one until I went to college. And so last night, I see this guy in the crowd, and I recognized him, but it didn't fit. It was a face that didn't fit. All of a sudden, backstage, this big guy comes backstage, and it was our handsome, tall, all-American quarterback from high school, who I know, but he hadn't seen me on stage since high school.
Wow.
He was walking down the street with his wife. They're in town for like...
Wow.
He said, hey, you know, my real name, John. John's here tonight, right? So they go in, and he's about 240 pounds, right?
He's huge.
He's gigantic. Like
he looked like the whole offensive line.
Not a big lineman, but he was a... And so I introduced him and said he hadn't seen me yet. And I said, it was so great to see that he had completely fallen apart. And he was a complete big, fat, you know, waste of time to... And what's funny is once I got going, I couldn't stop because it's the truth. He kept telling me how good I looked, and I kept thinking, "You look fucking terrible.
Yeah.
You look awful." It's great to see somebody, and no, he's a wonderful guy. But do you ever see? You ever go back to your high school reunions, Madison?
I haven't been to any of them yet because everybody looks fantastic.
They do.
I grew up with rich people. They're all waspy and blonde and fine.
Well, then you don't want to go back to that.
Some of them don't look so good, a couple, and I've seen them.
Yeah, that's the ones you want to
hang
with.
I was at a party with one a couple weeks ago at a Christmas party. She's wearing like a giant L.L. Bean wool sweater and a turtleneck up to her eyes, and it's a Christmas party. And I was like, oh.
Well, in my school, do you know that most of the guys I know married either their high school or their college sweetheart? So I knew his wife when she was 14, right?
Wow.
I look at that. I know. I look at that and I think they've been married like 40 years.
That's crazy.
Got kids like 40 years old, right? So it's like, you know, I'm looking at that and I don't know how you do that.
Yeah, like I'm listening to it. I'm going the same thing for 40 years.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
I don't know about that.
Yeah, and you know, they probably went through everything, you know, humanly possible. I haven't the faintest idea.
Sure, they probably got a swing in there.
Probably affairs and then denials and then reconciliations.
He kept saying to me, you know, I had to warn Lynette there was going to be cursing.
I heard that she's not a fan of stand-up.
She's not a, right.
Yeah, no. She was an attractive woman.
Well, so then I was in the wings, whatever you want to call it, and I would watch her, and, you know, everything is, you know, said on the thing. Did you say pussy or something? What did you say?
Pussy wet pills.
Oh. Pussy wet pills.
Oh, my God. So what is the bit you do?
I talk about how they have pills for everything on TV,
right,
and they have something to moisten up a woman down there, and I believe it's called the pussy wet pill.
I was standing
I loved that.
10 feet away from this.
They
go to church.
Yeah.
3 days a week at big Catholics. When you said pussy wet pill, well, he spits his drink out, right?
What'd she do?
Well, she laughed, but she was trying not to.
Right.
She can't help it. It's a funny name for a pill.
Oh, and you said it a bunch of times. So after about the third time, you know, she was dying, which made me laugh even harder. Here's the funny part. My agent, Don Buchwald, who, of course, is also Howard's agent, he comes to the show And he gets a seat in the middle. He's like 6 foot five, right?
He requested a seat up front, close to the stage.
He wears a fedora, like a, you know, like a gangster.
Man's got style. I'll give him that.
He heckles me from the first minute I come on.
He does.
Till the first minute, and I, he comes backstage before the show, and I go, Jesus, I'm so nervous. I'm afraid I'm going to die. He says, of course you're going to die.
And Jay looks at him and he goes, you're drunk, aren't you?
He says, you were never any good at this.
Wow.
He says, you're only good in the living room.
It was fantastic.
He said, what are you doing? You're trying to be a professional comedian. I'm going to kill you tonight.
Well, he came up to me because I went up to him immediately, of course, and I was like, hi.
Yeah.
I want to do voiceover work.
Yeah.
Here's my material. And I said, I work with Jay. And he said, Jay's not a good man.
No. Yeah.
Jay is a bad man.
Now, here's the sad
thing. I'm going to heckle him.
He has made so much money just taking care of Howard, just the 10% or whatever
he
makes.
Is he even agent?
He doesn't
anymore?
Need. He has a huge agency in New York and a huge agency in L.A. He does not need any of it. He just has them open to be nice. He has 200 people on his payroll. So you were giving him tapes and everything.
I didn't give him anything.
He doesn't even know where the voiceover department is.
No, he does, because I said, oh, I met so-and-so from your voiceover department. She didn't think too much of me. And he was like, well, she's the voiceover lady.
Yeah, they don't. She's so
tough
was,
shit.
Yeah, tough shit.
Go ahead.
One thing I was going to say that was really cool is I was really worried about the turnout for the show.
Oh, it was unbelievable.
It was great.
Not only was it great.
Who were those people?
But they said that was the biggest turnout all week at Caroline's, the largest crowd they've had all week at Caroline's.
Well, and did we promote it enough?
We promoted it a ton. And then I think there was a lot
people.
Of walk-ups.
Yeah, a lot of
because the tourist
wait,
season.
Watch this. Here's what Shuley says to me. Mm. I go, how many people? I said, I want strangers to come in. He says, don't worry. No, did you say it, Garrett? They'll be it. Garrett says to me, don't worry, there'll be walk-ups that'll just come in. I said, well, the crowd's not very big. No, no. And what's the number you gave me?
I said 10 to 15.
10 to 15 people?
Yeah. He says, don't worry, there'll be another 10 to 15. I go, the place holds 300 people.
Yeah.
I said, you know, you just don't know. You don't have any.
You don't know how to comfort people.
Social graces, or I don't really know what the deal is.
Social graces.
Yeah,
like Garrett will say,
a lot of people off the street.
It isn't
no,
a
it
lot
isn't.
Of people. You want to say to someone, "I think it's going to be packed."
Those you know, sluts from New Orleans were walking.
You know, there's some comedy clubs where they won't let you go up and do time unless you bring 10 people with
right.
you. They're called bringer shows, and you have to bring people with
well,
you.
When you're
now,
starting
they're
going to
pay
yeah.
us for last night.
Yeah.
What
yeah.
do we make? We make a piece of the crowd?
Of the door. Yeah.
Like what piece? 5%?
I think a little bit more.
Wow.
Yeah.
Now 19 comics jumped onto my paycheck.
But they're not. Not everybody who performs gets paid.
Why not?
Because it's your show. It's your call who you want to pay.
Oh, well, I got to give it
pay,
to everybody.
Pay
you don't have to.
And pay Shuley.
You don't have to. These guys, trust me, it's not a normal thing where, you know, like Judah Freelander, I did his show for him, okay? There were five comics on that show, and then Judah headlined.
I mean, I don't need the
Judah
money.
Judah didn't pay everybody, but, I mean.
I know, but how do you not pay everybody?
I understand what you're saying. I'm just saying, you know, it's something that
pisses me off now that I have to split this thing
oh,
up.
Oh, stop it.
By the way, what was the bill last night for all of you people?
I'm not sure, Jay.
What was the tip?
What was the tip?
Yeah.
Use Jay's credit card early yeah, no. and often. That's
Sean,
the tip.
Yeah.
We booked the meals for 16 people, which was like overkill.
16 times.
It was too much food. And
it was a lot
was
of food. We ended up giving. I ended up walking through the audience, handing out plates
oh,
of food.
Thank you, Sean, for doing that.
So that's,
well, I didn't
that's
want
really
it to go
nice,
away.
Because so, I was thinking of bringing it in with me. Because
it was
felt so
it was
bad.
Like $610 altogether for the 16 people.
And the tip.
That included the service fee. I think I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, it's automatic.
It's automatic. Which was 20%. But then.
People.
People at the table ordered more drinks afterwards.
On my credit card?
Yes.
Oh, Jesus.
Not me, Jay. Not me.
All right. Well, give me that receipt.
Well, you know
and,
what?
And that was, well, am I going to make $610?
I was going to say, you're probably going to end up owing Caroline $60 by the time all the figures are balanced out.
So that was $80.
That's a lot of money.
Garrett.
Worth of drinks.
Yeah. Yeah. So
somebody had three vodkas and it wasn't me.
It was Garrett.
I wanted a two drink minimum and then everybody pays their own after that Merry Christmas.
I know, but everybody just started ordering drinks and they brought me a bill. What was I supposed to say? Okay, everybody give me $10 each. Or
yes.
It's really a reflection of what kind of friends you have.
Yeah, no, exactly. It was awful. It was awful.
And then we went to Ruby Foo's and God knows how much that cost.
No, well, that was me. I that
I know,
was another $250.
Yeah, so that was a $1,000 night for you.
I know. So what do I make?
200.
Please. That $1,000 will be a scratch on your arm by the time this check comes your way.
For and you know what? Can we just say thanks to Robert, who came all the way and sat in the front, the man in the wheelchair.
The man in the wheelchair.
Oh, yeah. How about this?
Yeah,
I can't see that the guy's in a wheelchair. Oh. So for 5 minutes, I'm talking about, huh? You bang your wife good. I'm like, you give it to her good.
You know what? I saw that you were doing that, and I'm looking, I'm going, the guy's in a wheelchair, and he's going, do you bang your wife good and all that? And
I'm like, what's your favorite position? Meanwhile, he's got one.
You know what? You didn't know he was in the wheelchair.
No, not at all.
I didn't understand it. It was like, why is he on the wheelchair?
And I didn't know if I should look back at him and give an I'm sorry eye.
His wife said to me, and maybe they're listening
they're
now.
They're huge, huge fans.
He had a terrible operation, and you made him laugh tonight. And I'm thinking, man, I'm just getting to die in my middle of my set. You
like
know?
Patch Adams over here running around.
Now, this is the question I have for you. You've got what Beetlejuice? Name some of the disabled people that you've come in contact with.
Do we have enough time? All right,
no, but really, name them.
We have Beetlejuice
and some are dead.
Yeah,
that you hung with.
Oh yeah. Well,
it's not like Howard and the other people don't deal with them. You travel with these people, right?
Right.
So
right.
give me the disabled people you've worked with. The
well,
lineup.
There's Beetlejuice. There's Jeff the Drunk.
Right. Who, you've traveled with them.
Oh, yeah.
Been in the room with them.
Sure.
Right, right.
Sure.
Slept with them in a motel.
Not Jeff, but Beetle, yes.
Yeah,
I have.
Right. Oh. But eating dinner with these people on the road and all
that. Oh, yeah. I've eaten breakfast and watched Jeff drink, Jack and Cokes at 7 a.m.
Right.
Beetlejuice, Jeff the Drunk, High Pitch Eric, who I think is a little brain.
He was there last night.
They put a big sign up on the green room door, J. Thomas's green room, and everything looks professional. I'm like, wow, this is going to be awesome. 2 seconds later, hey, Jay!
Oh, that's right. He came back there?
Yeah, he said the whole night.
He goes anywhere and everywhere.
He's got some nerve.
There's Fred the Elephant Boy. He's got a severe speech impediment.
Oh, I
right.
him.
There's Eric the Midget, who's in a wheelchair and kind of... will right. perform.
Soft hands, though.
Very soft. Kenneth Keith Kallenbach, who was just a really weird guy out of Philly. He just passed away not too long ago. Cliff Pallett, the guy with a cleft palate.
Oh, I don't know him.
He passed away not too long ago.
Twitchells.
So here's my
alive
question.
And kicking, thank God.
Well, I mean, in all of your life, you know, so this is the last, eight years of your life this has been? How many?
I'd say the last 4 years.
4 years of your life. What has this done to your feeling about disabled people? And I mean, last night it's a wonderful guy,
right?
But I'm in the company of a man jumping around in his seat at dinner time,
kaboo,
and all of that stuff. What has it done to your feeling about the disabled?
Well, part of me is jealous a lot of the times because I'm like, man, if I had Tourette's, I'd have a Broadway show by now. You know, I'd do 4 hours.
That's not right. You wouldn't.
No.
But I'll tell you what, comics are like that. Comics will be in the back of the room, and if there's a guy on stage in a wheelchair and his jokes aren't good, they'll go in the bed, they'll elbow each other and go, call that a wheelchair joke. I could have wrote one better than that. And that's how comics are. Like, they'll see somebody with an angle, and they're jealous.
But has it affected you in your thinking about when you see a person in a wheelchair, or these people are like entertainers, or they're oddities?
No, it hasn't changed. I'll tell you why. Because there's a guy named Eric the Midget, who's a little midget out in San Francisco, right? He's little. He's tiny. He was supposed to be dead 10 years ago. He's still alive.
Right.
The guy's got all the luck in the world, yet you'll never meet a more bitter, angry...
He doesn't really have that much luck, Shuli. Let's face it.
He's still alive. Like, if you had a thing of milk in your fridge, and 10 years from now you went in and it was still good...
What kind of life does he have?
Yeah, what is that?
What kind of life does he have?
He's shorter than Vern Troyer.
How about this? He was up at the Bunny Ranch 2 weeks ago banging two whores. How's that for a life?
Okay.
All right.
That can't continue.
So what you've done is...
But he's a bitter, angry little...
He is. He's bitter.
Okay, now you've said it without saying it. You look upon the disabled. In fact, they're not retards and they're not disabled. We have to think of another area to put these people in. Their entertainment... Disabled.
Entertainment oddities.
They're entertainment oddities that you hang with.
Yes.
So what you have done is you
freaks.
You have made them level with the rest of humanity, and they should be glad that they're alive. Right?
Either I've made them level or I've gone down to their level.
I can't figure it out. Yeah. I can't figure it out.
Well, but I have to say, like, Shuley and Bob Levy, they're very kind to these freaks.
To these
Well, they're our paycheck. I mean, seriously.
Now, here's the other thing.
But on the other side, are you using them? Or do you genuinely
feel... Well, let's break
feel,
it down.
Do you genuinely... Okay, yeah, break it down.
Break it down. Let me ask you this.
You're probably not wild about Beetlejuice.
Not at all. Let me ask you
but
this.
But you love Twitchells.
What kind of life do you think Beetlejuice would have if not for the Stern Show and the Comedy Show?
None.
Okay, so it's like a two-way street.
In this, in one aspect, yeah,
he's a little shit.
Some people may be offended or bothered by the fact that there's a mentally challenged black midget on stage,
right.
Doing jokes, telling people.
Does he do jokes?
Yeah, like we'll pick a guy out of the crowd. I'll be like, Beetle, that guy wanted to kick your ass, and he's like, who, him? I go, yeah. I go, sir, how tall are you? And the guy's like, 6'2". I go, tell him how tall you are. Me? I'm 6'22". Like, and he just, and everything, how much you weigh? 220. How much you weigh? 312. Like, and the guy's at my hip, you know?
Well, the one that bothers me, I think, is Gary the Retard. I always feel so bad for him.
But, they're, you look at it this way.
That makes me sad.
Their lives, at least, Beetlejuice walks through an airport and people surround,
right.
Like he's
You're
Ali.
Right.
Like he's
All
Muhammad
right.
Ali.
Right.
I think, in one aspect, that's a great story for these guys is at least
what would happen if you had a child,
yeah,
with this girlfriend of yours, and it's a little one of the, and you know, you smoke marijuana, and
sure,
all the time. You could have completely destroyed all your DNA by
absolutely.
Now. You have a Beetlejuice.
Oh,
your
shit.
Child is
right.
A Beetlejuice.
Right. What do I do?
What would you do?
Two shows on Saturday, one show on Friday.
Ladies and gentlemen, Shuley, the great Shuley.
And you gave me the nicest introduction last night, man. That was so
well,
nice
the truth.
Of you.
It's absolutely true.
It was awesome.
You know, you travel around, you and I met you, and we kind of and you introduced me to
Madison
over here, and I
I'm just so happy shit worked out last night, man. So nervous.
Yeah, but you know what? I made everybody so nervous, but they're all going, it's going to go well, it's going to go
yeah.
well. And my agent came back and said, look, it may not go well. That'll be funny, too.
Odds are you're going to die.
Right. Okay. We'll talk to you at Howard. No, you call 888-STERN, 101. We'll have some guys coming on from a show here where they it's a charm school. Do you know this show, Madison?
Yeah, my friend Troy is the producer of this show.
Is it a good show?
Yeah, it's called Game On, the show, and it's right here. It's on our other channel, 108 Stars 2.
Oh, it is? Oh, it's over there with us?
And, teaches courses for men and women on how
what?
To, you know.
What?
I got a sneeze.
So
why did you stop the sneeze?
You gotta let those out.
I don't want to be rude.
Is that why you do it?
That's bad for you.
I didn't want to
sneeze. We talked
all
about
over
this
everyone.
The other day. That people that go,
sorry.
Don't do that. Sneeze.
I didn't want to sneeze all over the
no,
place.
No, but you're not supposed to let it go into your body. That's bad.
Oh, sorry.
And people think you're stupid.
Oh.
Bush League.
No, when people go, Scarlett Johansson blew her nose.
Uh-oh, and her tits
exploded.
Oh,
yeah. Why don't we put this on eBay?
And her blew tits her nose on The Tonight Show. And
I heard about that.
She said she caught a cold from Samuel L. Jackson. Jay Leno handed her a tissue. She put it on eBay, and the bids are up to $2,200 for her snot in a rag.
I don't believe it.
Wouldn't you like to get that thing?
That makes me more jealous than a Tourette's comic.
Take the DNA, okay?
Yeah.
Build,
oh, yeah,
clone Scarlett Johansson. Feed it, raise it, keep it in like a broom.
Bang it.
And then when it's 21, just get on top of it.
21?
21. It's my Scarlet.
Yeah.
Came on when I say it's on. 21.
And you know what you do? You feed her so that those milky blue veined breasts of hers get even bigger.
You just tell the cops, how are you going to arrest me? I made it.
Yeah.
She acts like normal people are, you know, going for her snot on eBay.
Do you think it's for real?
Do you think it's
really her snot?
No. I saw a video of it.
Come on.
She blew her nose.
You can't sell snot on the internet.
Oh, you'd be surprised what you
can
sell.
Smell
people
a
have
smell.
Sold kidneys on there.
Yeah, you can sell snot on the internet. There are guys that are going to get her snot-filled tissue and going to, put it in some sort of a case. Right?
I got to tell you, I would rather pay $2,200 for her snot-filled rag than $12.99 for her CD that just came out.
No, you wouldn't.
Do you have
any?
Have
you heard it?
Yeah, she's got it.
Okay,
I kind of like it.
No, wait a
second. It's Tom Waits. Remember, we talked about Tom Waits. It's Tom Waits covers.
Can you imagine you are in your room and you have her snot, you know, thing.
Right.
And you masturbate and you mix your jizz with Scarlett's snot.
I'm with you.
That's what we're talking about.
Right.
That's what we're talking about.
Sure. That's what guys are buying it for.
That's exactly what they're buying it for.
Hey, man, I shot a load all over her schnookus last night.
Which song is this?
This is Scarlett Johansson, the actress.
Anywhere I Lay My Head.
She sings.
I've heard worse.
The background.
This isn't the right song. You shouldn't have picked this one.
Yeah.
It's the only one in here.
Really?
No, you can't hear it. It's hard to hear. She's in the background.
Maybe we should stop talking.
She can't sing. It's mixed that way.
Hold on. Pull it down. It's like if I did the show from back here. Like,
right.
Like this, you know.
No, I think she can sing. I think she just chose to cover Tom Waits, who's just... Ugh.
Listen, why would you cover him?
Because it's pretentious. People like Tom Waits.
But if she can sing, why didn't she start as a singer?
Can I be honest?
A lot of actors can sing, though, Shuli. You know that.
Can I be honest? Tom Waits is absolutely terrible.
Horrible.
And that
we had this discussion one day on the show.
He is successful, and they consider him some sort of a talent.
He's garbage.
Do you know what his hobby is?
What?
He goes to the Oakland dump. And he spends hours at the dump getting stuff. And I used to see him at this restaurant down near where I used to live, this place called Victor's Delicatessen. And he and these guys, kind of homeless-looking guys, coughing and smoking and talking like that. Who, if I can't sing, right, at all,
right,
but I could do what he does.
Right.
How do you think, where do you get the balls to think, it's just balls.
It's balls.
You're surrounded by yes people that just constantly blow smoke up your ass.
But who says, yes, you have a good voice, you can sing?
Whoever
says
wants
that?
To collect a paycheck the following week.
I mean,
are
his lyrics that strong? Is that what it is?
You know what? We'll play him in a few
minutes.
Isn't
Garrett a fan?
I have friends of mine that listen to him, worship him, and all this stuff. And I go, maybe a song, one song he'll do okay.
Oh, he's no! It's unlistenable.
Yeah, absolutely.
He's Neil Young to me and Bob Dylan all in one.
Well, I don't. They can sing, but he
really
cannot sing at all in the least. Nothing, and then you look at that and you think, how did he have the guts to even get on a stage and start doing it? Or my friends would have said to me, "What are you doing?"
Right.
How come nobody said anything to him? Like, you know.
Because maybe it was the 60s and everybody was on acid and high. I don't know. Sean, what do you think? You know Tom Waits.
I like his writing. I don't think he's a great performer.
See, that's what it is. It's the writing.
Yeah,
People get into the lyrics.
I think like, give me a line that means something.
I have no idea. I couldn't tell you the lyrics, but I like his writing.
I think he wrote about pussy wet pills.
Wait a second. You like his lyrics, but you can't remember one.
Why would I remember them?
Because you just said it's like...
Well, I'm not a huge fan, but I think he's a good writer. I just don't think he's a great performer. He doesn't have a great voice. God, this, that.
Yeah, he's not a singer, right?
Yeah. But I think he's a good writer. Otherwise, why would people cover his stuff?
Because they're stupid. Because
there's lots of other shit out there. Why would they choose Tom Waits to cover?
His lyrics must be good.
Well, we'll listen to some of that. The Jay Thomas Show. And we'll talk to you at 888 Stern 101. Shuli, Madison, and I are here on Howard 101. Christmas, of course, is, 6 days away?
Right around the corner, Jeff.
There you go. And if you can't travel this Christmas, but you want to be there in spirit, you send flowers. I actually use Pro Flowers and got a great compliment from a woman that I sent them to at the Sheraton Hotel in New Orleans, that they give me free rooms because I went to high school with that guy, too.
Small world.
It is. Get 15 Christmas tulips mixed with fragrant Douglas fir in a free glass vase, all for $29.99. Or just $10 more and get 30% more tulips and a festive keepsake candy cane striped vase.
Oh!
That says it all.
Put your pencils and all that in there when the stuff's gone. These are incredible values. Over $15 in savings with the colorful bouquet and the premium holiday vase. You can do it from the comfort of your own truck cab. You just get on the telephone, you dial 800-PRO-FLOWERS, and now type in Jay Thomas if you're doing it online at proflowers.com. There is a microphone up in the right-hand corner. Is that right?
That's
you
right.
Click on that, and if you do it, I don't know, what do I get anything for that? I don't quite understand what the deal is.
You don't, but they get magically teleported to a beautiful land filled with flowers.
But do I get a bonus for that? Or what? I mean, it's kind of an endorsement, isn't it?
Occasionally you get free flowers.
I haven't gotten that in a while.
Well, that's because you told me you didn't want them, so I take them.
Oh, I see. Okay, that's fine. I just
want to see what the internet traffic's like.
800-PRO-FLOWERS, and don't forget to use the code JTHOMAS so that Sean Kelly and his family can enjoy the lovely blooms. The offer will end today, at the end of the day, so don't wait to place your order. It is the Jay Thomas Show. Shuley and Madison are here, and 888-STERN, 101. Do you have some Tom Waits? All right.
Can you get rid of it?
It's worse than you could imagine.
You know what? Can we hear it, please?
Let me be the judge.
Okay.
This is awful.
They hung a sign up in our town. If you live it up, you won't live it.
Sean, this is the shit you like. Go ahead. Here, let's
So she left Monterey.
That would make it better.
Yeah, that's it up.
Wait, I'm going to try and listen. You love
just like a bullet leaves.
What's wrong with that, Jay?
I want to hear the words that you like.
I like them all.
No, you don't?
Yeah.
With the charcoal eyes and Monroe Hills.
What?
Charcoal eyes and Monroe Hills.
California trip.
You know, your grating voice doesn't help it.
Charcoal Mountain Hill.
Yeah.
California. Don't you like that, right?
All right, let's be quiet for a
hold on. You gotta hold on. Take my hand. Standing right here, you gotta hold on.
It's like I would be loading the gun with the bottle of bourbon next to me. And like,
this is spoon lighting music as you're cooking up the heroin.
This isn't as bad as this is good compared to the other stuff.
What
I don't
understand is that who went into a joint and said this is good?
How about wearing berets and they were smoking joints?
What do you do at a Waits concert?
I don't
smoke
know.
A joint.
I don't know.
And wear a beret.
It is the Jay Thomas Show and Brian of Cleveland. Yes, sir. How are you, Brian?
Jay, love the show.
Thank you. Do you like Tom Waits?
You're totally off base about Tom Waits. If Sirius had a Tom Waits channel, I would listen to it 24/7.
Well, that makes one of you.
You know what, Brian? A lot of times you just do stuff because, you know, you're going to get phone calls and start a controversy and all that.
I guarantee you after hour 7 of the Tom Waits channel, you're not going to be a fan.
Have you been to a Tom Waits concert?
I've been to 3.
What do you do?
He is an awesome piano player. He is an incredible songwriter. His songs have been performed by Rod Stewart, Bruce Springsteen, the Eagles. His voice is not bad. It's distinctive. In fact, he has made a fortune suing people who have copied his voice.
Oh, get out of here.
Like Harvey
Fierstein?
I'm
not kidding.
Harvey Fierstein who plays the mama in Hairspray,
guy? Yeah, he sued Harvey.
Do you have any Harvey Fierstein from Hairspray that would like to play the big fruit that
Gary,
plays the
mother?
Gary,
you might be able to find him in Fiddler
Now,
well.
You know what, Brian? Do you take dates and stuff? Do you have a woman that you take with you? And does she enjoy the concert with you?
Let me tell you a story, Jay.
Sure,
I took my ex-wife to a Tom Waits concert.
Yeah.
It was her first time seeing Tom Waits. She was so moved, she cried.
Did she leave you right after that or wait a week? Does he have a holiday album? Does he have a Sounds of the Season?
Let me tell you, Jingle Bell. Tom Waits has so many Tom Waits has so many fans.
Christmas.
Yeah.
And they hold an annual Waitstock Festival in New York for Tom Waits fans.
Maybe we should go, Jay.
By hundreds of thousands of people.
Okay.
All right, easy with the hundreds of thousands.
Yeah.
Well, to tens of thousands.
Stop it, bro.
Come on, two vans.
Does he have, does Tom Waits have a Christmas CD?
I don't believe so.
Boy, I'll tell you, I wish he did. I would.
All
love,
I want for Christmas
is my two front teeth.
Two front teeth and a bottle of Jack.
But you know what? That music, at least, when you're sitting at midnight, Christmas night, and you've just, you know,
you've just taken apart your 9mm, you're cleaning it.
No, you've laid the presents out for the most depressing thing in the world is after you've laid the presents out for the kids.
Right.
And it's like 1 a.m, and you and your wife are sitting across from each other, and you realize this is your life, okay?
Yeah, yeah.
You got the brats asleep. You haven't been laid in about 8 months.
And there's nobody up wrapping your fucking presents.
Nobody is helping you. And you're looking at each other and you're not saying anything, but you know that you're stuck in this life.
Yeah.
Right? And a Tom Waits Christmas song would come on. Oh, holy night.
All through the house.
Yeah.
No one was stirring.
Yeah, that's, you know, people always say you paint such a grim picture of marriage and family life. I would say that that's the true picture of marriage and family life. But for some reason, you know, like the salmon that goes down the river, goes out into the sea for a couple of years, and then comes back and fights their way through the rocks and everything else to die, to get to the top of the river and die. And you would think, well, why wouldn't you stay in the ocean and live and die like some other death, like maybe be swallowed by a shark, anything but banging your body and your testicles against rocks to go up a river and then to die.
Come
right?
on, it's not that bad for everyone.
Hold it.
What do you know? You don't have salmon testicles.
Thank you. Rub it in.
Hold it. That's marriage right around the holidays. You're going up, back up the stream to die.
There's no joy.
There is some joy. I didn't get married for real until I was much older, and I'm living longer than I thought I was going to live.
You enjoy marriage, and you love your children, so stop
but
it.
Listen, they are fine, but they listen, I've had bomb threats. I've had them steal.
Love, fires. Love they were lighting themselves on fire.
They've done everything.
Love is a strong word. I think he's no. okay with it.
I think my wife feels exactly the same way I do. We stare at each other, and God forbid, I should say, should we really say what we're thinking right now?
Mm-mm.
It'll be over.
Oh, yeah.
I think if 90% of the husbands and wives looked at each other and started really...
And were honest?
Forget it. Forget it.
There
it's
are
over.
Some good marriages out there.
You ever see an animal in the... You know, like when you see a horse or a cow or something like that, and they're just kind of staring off, you know? That's what husbands look like when they're with their families.
I remember my mom would be in the other room, and she'd call my dad, and she'd be like, Eli! And my dad would just look at me and roll his eyes and go, and just give me this look like, I hear, but I ain't answering.
Aww.
Right.
And she'd go, Eli! And you'd just sit there.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
And she'd walk in, she'd go, what, you don't hear me? And he goes, I'm sorry, I had the air conditioning on. Like air conditioning is louder than a human being speaking.
I've said this before, and I'll say it again. Go this holiday season, and you see the kind of really cute girl pushing the baby's in the carriage, and the guy's got the baby, and he's a young, handsome guy, and she is so excited. She's got the children, she's had the children and everything else, and this guy is thinking, where's that gal that was going down on me doing blow in the back of the limousine that we used to get Christmas Eve?
Where's the chick I double-teamed with the stick shift of my car?
And whatever it is. And now you're married. And how do you explain it? I haven't the faintest idea.
It's over.
It's kind of over because it's over. Yeah, you're right. It's over.
Like when you watch footage, and, you know, this was a terrible tragedy, but it's like watching footage of those astronauts getting on that space shuttle, you know, that Challenger thing. Mm-hmm. And you're watching and you're going, I know what's going to fucking happen, and it's not going to end well.
Marriage is like getting on the Challenger.
That's what I'm saying.
All right, that's
wow,
a good one.
Shuli, it's too soon.
Hey, you know what? Play me some uplifting. Play me that, Brian, I'm doing this for you. Play me the uplifting Tom Waits record again, please. Here we go.
So I guess I shouldn't be looking for a husband.
All
then.
He has. I know. You know what? You shouldn't.
Or go on a space shuttle. One of the.
How about
you should
a
go
date?
To a foreign country.
How about sex?
No, take in a young...
Lover?
Foreign boy, and just
Nice Spaniard.
I get attached.
Yeah, that's a sad. Hey, Brian, have a good holiday, all right?
Thank you, sir. If you live it up,
you won't live it down. This is for everybody that's married during the holidays.
This isn't bad. Left Monte Rio,
son. Oh. This song's called Whoopee, I Love Life.
Jesus.
We're not hearing the full effect of his gravelly voice, though. We're hearing it soft. With a charcoal eyes and
Monroe hips. Oh, he has that lyric in every song.
It's the same song, you idiot.
But y'all kidding aside, he ought to do a Christmas album.
I'm sure there is one.
Hank of Ohio. Yes, Hank, the Jay Thomas
Show.
That's
a good name, Hank.
How are you?
I like
it
that
is.
Name.
You don't hear that name. It's Henry, right? Henry is your real name? Yeah. Hank is a strong. You know, Bill Murray's brother, Joel Murray, named his sons Hank and Gus.
Ooh, aww. That's cool.
Those are great names.
That's
right?
Cool.
They're like cat names.
That's like the cast. That's like Bonanza.
You know what I mean? You know, you go to somebody's house. Yeah. You know what I like? I have a son named Jake, and there's always a lab named Jake. We would go to somebody's house, and they would go, "Hey, this is my son Jake." And he'd go, "That's my lab, Jake."
Right. That's great.
I'd love to start naming your kids Duke. Name your kids like dog names,
or you give know? your pets like
Mike.
People names. Yeah. Like, yeah, this is my
Steven.
Cat Dennis. Like.
And my daughter, Fluffy.
Right.
Okay. Yes, sir. Go ahead. Yes, Hank, what can we do for you? Thanks for calling.
All right. The Tom Waits comment about the dirt gravel voice, it never used to be like that in the old, like his old stuff. He really had a really nice voice. I guess he really just started doing the, you know, dirt gravel voice stuff in, you know, 10 or 15 years.
You know, I don't
so
think
he really, did, he really took over the he really took over, you know, music when he started doing that, because, you know, no one else was doing it, so he just continued.
You're saying that his voice was good,
but he found a market. He found
for bad singing.
Yeah,
it was, you know what, it was beautiful back in the day. He had like a, I mean, and I'm not gay or anything, but he had a really good singing voice.
I remember seeing on VH1.
I'm not gay or nothing.
Wait, I remember seeing on on VH1 Behind the Music. They said, you know, Tom Waits was sitting around one day and he goes, "Why is everybody doing such a good job on these records? Why is everybody sounding so good? I'm gonna go.
His cult like following is insane. All right, because I went to a concert in Florida a couple months ago.
Yeah,
and he this is the only concert he done, I think, in the U.S. this whole year.
Right,
and it sold out in 3 minutes.
Wow, how many people? What does that place hold? 60 people.
He has a song called Chocolate Jesus that might be holiday-ish.
Chocolate Jesus. Okay, do you have Chocolate Jesus by Tom Waits? Okay. Do we have Tom Waits?
This was originally going to be the Obama
let's
campaign.
Let's do Chocolate
song.
Jesus.
Chocolate
and you know
Jesus.
What? I'm glad you brought it up. We will find some early Tom Waits. Thank you very much, Hank. We have
right,
Chocolate
well.
Jesus. Thank you so much.
Hey,
you know,
Hank, take her easy.
I ain't gay or nothing.
I ain't gay or nothing, but the guy's got a sweet
every
voice.
Every time a guy says anything meaningful, you know, I ain't gay or nothing.
Yeah.
You know, like, what is this?
Chocolate Jesus.
Here we go, Tom Waits.
For the holidays.
For the holidays, here we go. Oh, what is it?
I know this song.
He's playing like a bucket. He's playing like a bucket with a string on it.
Rubber band.
Yeah, with a string on it. Yeah, there you go. Don't go to church. Oh, please. Sunday. Don't get on my knees to pray. Oh, my God. Don't and it's a rooster. It's a rooster in it.
I thought it was Twitchell's version.
Got my own special way. I know Jesus loves me. Maybe just a little bit more. Fall down on my knees every Sunday.
What do you think it costs to produce this?
The guy hits play and record at the same time on the tape deck and walks out.
There's a rooster in the song. We're not adding that. Do you have any pig sounds? Do you have any pig sounds? Do you have any other farm animals? What idiots we are. We make people famous. We make people rich. That ought to be homeless. Should have been a homeless guy.
There ain't nothing there.
Why would he have the cuckoo clock in there? We're not adding
it. The only thing that can pick me up.
He's making fun of us.
Remember when you used to make mixtape for a chick and you'd like record a radio song off the radio, then you'd jump to you and you'd be like, "Hey, this one's going out to you." That sounds better than this recording right here.
It's got a bird sound in here.
Is this a cereal commercial?
I don't know what
am I listening to?
Oh Jesus, with the
part of this nutritious breakfast.
All right. Take it out.
Take it out. Do you have any Tom Waits early music? Any of his early when he sounded
early?
Really good? I'm not gay or nothing.
Yeah.
But do you have his voice when he was, you know, younger? Can you find the really, you know, the young stuff? No, you idiot. What I said to play. The bit, you idiot. The bit.
Now this is more like it.
You know what Garrett's doing? I'm looking. I don't see anything new. Idiot.
Don't have years.
Idiot. Can you play a chicken in here? Play something.
I don't have chicken.
All right, there you go. All right, there's early Tom Waits.
Okay.
Boy, we went around our ass to get to our thumb on that one. Yes. Let's go to Mark of Boston. Mark, the Jay Thomas Show. Yes, sir. Shuley is here. Madison is here. And we're bringing these two guys in because, you know, there's synergy here, and you want to introduce the people that are on the channel. They have a charm
and
show.
And they're cute.
Morning, everybody.
They have a charm show in the afternoon on the channel that we just moved to, Sirius 108, right? Yes. Go ahead, Mark.
Yeah, what's going on? I mean, Miserable Men Production is kicking ass over fucking Jay Thomas. What's going on?
What does that mean?
Well, I mean, the production value. I mean, you pull out a bit and you can't even work that. What's going on?
Well, it's Garrett's fault.
You know what, Mark? Don't ask. Don't act like you know. You know what? Do you
radio?
You're sitting at home and you're talking to us about production value. Just either don't like it. Just switch it off or something.
Let me talk to my friend Mark Marconi out in Boston.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. We're just fooling around. It's early in the morning. What do you want us to be sharp?
No, you get these people calling in talking about this thing. And obviously,
then turn it off. Then turn it off. You know what? I hope I've ruined your day. Turn it off.
We hope we're the Tom Waits of morning radio.
You have to understand something. I don't care how you feel. I could care less. So don't listen to it. Just stop.
Well, you know, you can take it up a notch. Maybe give Beetle a call.
I don't want to take it up a notch. Just stop. Just turn it off. Listen.
Wait. One more
something
thing.
Else.
Jay, what? Listen. You know, you had this bang up comedy show. I mean, you think you're going on tour with Alan Richards soon?
No, you know what? You're too much of a fan of the other thing. I'm never going to be Howard, so don't listen on Friday. Just don't listen. I mean, you know what? It's like when your wife is screwing the other guy. It's you know, it's just, you know, she doesn't feel like being with you, so just don't listen.
So either jump in and bang her
with
the guy.
Yeah, either enjoy it or don't, but I don't need the comment because I can't do anything about it. I came with this act, and I got to leave with it. There's nothing I can do.
It is what it is.
Mark, I cannot improve.
You ever pull a Bob Levy and...
I've never... You want to hear the truth? And I mean, I'll say this from the bottom of my heart. And you know this. I've never heard Bob Levy. I've never heard Beetlejuice. I've never heard the Howard Stern Show, ever. So I don't know any of these people.
You also got to understand Jay was on at the same time as Howard
was.
Yeah,
I don't know
his
who anybody
career,
is. So if you're out there, jerking off and listening to that, this ain't the show for
why
you.
Why are you even wasting your breath? There's callers out there who want to talk to us.
You know why? I want to make it easy on the guy. That's why.
Madison, shut your dick, liquor. Will you listen? Jay, doesn't Levy have two comedy clubs?
I have to tell you, I know their names. I've met them on the phone and all. But if you haven't been on my show, I haven't met you, I don't know you. I don't know. So you're listening to the wrong show. That's all.
Well, you know, you still haven't mentioned your kid once, so I'll let you go ahead and do that.
It is not going to get any
better. He was at the show last night, by the way.
It isn't going to get any better.
Shuley, please help out a little bit, a little help.
I can't. My dick liquor's been sealed since 7 a.m.
Actually, I'm going to use that.
Oh, yeah. That's a good
dick
liquor?
Yeah.
Hey, Marky, I'll talk to you later.
Peace, brother.
Oh, he's a friend of yours.
Well, he calls Miserable Men from time to time. He's not a friend. I don't know the guy personally. I just know him as a caller.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh,
so
thanks.
His name's really not Mark Marconi, though.
No, it isn't.
No, it's not
Mark. No, that's a man that started radio.
Right.
Oh, my God. Idiot. Robert.
I'm surrounded.
Robert from Great Neck was in the wheelchair last night at Caroline's.
Thanks for bumming everybody out,
and,
Robert.
And Yashuli was mentioning you with the wife and the whole thing. Let me apologize. He did not see the wheelchair.
I saw the wheelchair. I was mortified.
Why are you in the wheelchair? What happened to you?
Well, let me just tell you, Jay. Mm-hmm. I don't have to be in the wheelchair. I'm a bilateral amputee. I lost both my legs to diabetes.
Oh, my God. Wow. Robert, I want to apologize.
No, I thought he was faking
it. No problem.
You know what? I saw you in the wheelchair, but I didn't want to look at your legs, and they're not there.
Well, I have prosthetic legs.
I was about to say, I thought I saw legs.
Right. And I can walk around. It's just
and
when I go
still,
the
he
city.
Has a wife, and he gets laid.
But when you walk around, is it like kind of robotic when you walk, or
like an action figure?
Is it natural?
Well, 2 summers ago, I lost the right leg, and so
God.
And then last summer, I lost the second one, the second going from one leg to zero legs is actually easier than going from two to one.
You know about you? How positive you are. Going from one to zero is better.
Did you ever think that it's not diabetes and maybe summer is slowly taking you piece by piece?
Here's what I love about people like you. You got both legs gone, and I've worked with them, and they come in with no legs, and they go, have a nice day. They're the happiest people in the world, you know?
Yeah.
You come in, you know they don't have their legs, and they're happy.
If
Robert,
you were in a wheelchair and you had no legs, in all honesty, would you be out at a comedy club looking to laugh
I
and
would
have a good
be
time?
In my room going, planning, plotting. First, I'd kill Mark of Boston. But I would be plotting. I would be plotting everybody's demise. I would be the angriest, most unhappy son of a bitch in the world.
Well, you're like that now, and everything's fine.
How do you do it, Robert?
I don't know if that's true, Jay.
How do you do it? How do you keep you? After God has just... Hold it. We've got the guy Twitchells. He's got Tourette's. He's a sweet guy. God has taken your legs. God has just...
He's laughed in your face.
How do you get up every day?
Well, I got to tell you, Jay, I mean, there's no alternative. I could sit around and, you know, do nothing, or I could go... You know, go out and do things, and that's what I do. I'm a lawyer in the real world. And,
wow.
Yeah.
Now, when you go into court, you know what it's like when a boxer comes in and he's already the champion? They say they give him a round or two. You pull into the courtroom with no legs in the wheelchair. Don't you think you kind of got a few votes already from the jury or the judge? Because...
I'm sorry I'm late, ladies and gentlemen of the jury. They took the ramp out.
But, I mean, what sort of law do you practice?
Immigration law.
Oh. So you come in with the non-speaking immigrant person.
They must be like, look at my lawyer.
And then you wheel in like that. I mean, do you think
Caramba.
Ay caramba.
Like, I hope they didn't catch him and do this to him.
Amputitatios.
Amputado.
Now, how do you say amputee in Spanish?
I don't speak I don't speak Spanish that fluently.
You help these immigrants and you don't speak the language. That's like me not listening to the Howard Stern show.
Yeah.
Well, the secretary does.
Okay. The secretary speaks Spanish.
Yep.
Okay. So you help them out. Do you think you get a little break because of the wheelchair?
I'll tell you a funny story, Jay. I went to a citizenship interview about 2 weeks ago, and my client had a walker, and I was on the wheelchair. And there was
a telethon just rolled through the door?
No, what is it? Unamundo? What is the name of
Telemundo.
Telemundo. The Telemundo.
Like,
telethon.
Where's the guy? Is the bumblebee? Is he behind you, too?
Oh, I love that guy.
Raising money, yeah. So he's on the walker, you're in the wheelchair, yeah.
Right. There's a room full of people. It usually takes about 4 or 5 hours to get called. Wow, I had a citizenship interview. We were out of there in about 10 minutes.
Nice.
They wanted to get the Crips ready to go. Well, thank you. You know what your wife said? She said, he's just come out of the hospital and You made him laugh tonight. Did you laugh at us last night at Caroline's?
I laughed my ass off. I had my satellite.
God forbid you lose your ass now. That would be even worse.
Watch out this summer.
No legs, no nothing.
But well, while I was in the hospital, I had the satellite radio, and I always listened to Jay Thomas. It made me laugh.
Robert, thank you very much. Robert, a great neck. If anybody's having immigration problems, can we give your office a plug? Who do they call?
My office is in Great Neck, 516.
No, what's the name of it?
Oh, Law Offices of Robert Hollander.
The Law Offices of Robert Hollander, and these are for people that they're going to deport?
Want to become citizens, if they're getting deported, if they want to become residents.
You have a lot of Arab clients that they say are terrorists. Are you doing that thing?
Actually, no. A lot of my clients are from South America.
Just South America. Okay.
Yeah.
Now, when they come in here, do they have a chance of staying now or no?
Of course they have a chance. If they have family here, if they have, U.S. citizen girlfriend, spouse,
You can have a U.S. citizen girlfriend and that you can stay because of that?
Well, if you get them to marry you.
Married, yeah.
Oh, but they know that's a scam.
No, it's not. I would probably say, I don't know for sure, but I'd probably say 90% of the marriages that I handle, they're
a scam if the person is gay, I think.
Now, do you use your prosthetic legs or do you stay in the wheelchair in the courtroom?
No, to be honest with you, Jay, when I go to the city and, with all the traffic there and everything, it's just easier in the wheelchair. But I can walk. I drive with hand controls. I get around.
Now, I would think that if you're losing a case, you would be walking around the courtroom. And then is there a way that one
just
of your
loosen
legs
it
could come off?
Yeah,
one leg comes off.
Whoops. I'm sorry. Excuse me, ladies and gentlemen of the jury. I have to pick up my prosthetic leg.
Yeah. Have you ever used your disability? I mean, we don't want to say totally consciously, but it was a good thing when it happened that your leg came off.
I never used it as an exhibit or anything, but
Held it up, exhibit A, that kind of thing?
I had a guy at the airport in Vegas one time. He was in his own private wheelchair when I was a wheelchair pusher, and he was at the wrong gate. So they call us and they say, look, we have to get a pusher to take him to the right gate. I show up at the gate. The guy's got a wheelchair, and he doesn't have foot rests for his feet. And by law, we're not allowed to push somebody without foot rests because they could slam their feet down and fall out, and they could sue us. So now this guy needs to get to his gate, and I have to tell him I can't even push him because he doesn't have foot pegs. So I go to him. I said, sir, I can't push you without the foot peg. He looks at me. He goes, oh, really? Takes his left leg, spins it completely. Takes his right leg, spins that. Now, both his legs are in an X formation under his chin with his shoes sticking out under his chin.
No.
And he looks at me, and he goes, that good enough for you? And I said, fuck it, let's go. And I pushed him to the gate like that. And people are walking towards us. And it's like, oh, my God. Like, it's a guy just got hit by a bus. Like he got an X with his legs.
Amazing. All right. Robert of Great Neck, have a fabulous legless holiday.
Great meeting you, man.
All right. Thank you very much.
Hi, Robert.
Shelley and Madison are here. It's the Jay Thomas Show, loved by a few. And it's Howard 101. Well, again, back out on the road so that you can keep living the style of life you're used to.
Not only that, but, I mean, let's be honest.
Yeah.
Slashing a wrist, it doesn't come with instructions. I mean,
it's down the, what is it, Garrett? the street and down
Garrett,
the lane.
You hate life. How do you do
down
it properly?
Down the road, not across the street.
Down the road, not across the
God!
Street.
God! I couldn't touch myself with a knife.
I heard that this Mindy chick tried to slash some guy's tires and hit his gas tank. So she's just all off.
All right.
Oh, now I've crossed the line. Screw you guys.
No, not cross the line. It wasn't all right. Wasn't funny.
What are you going to do? I'm not a morning person.
Oh, that's good. That's good to hear. Joshua Pelosier and Jordan Harbinger, is that it?
That's correct.
All right. They go to theartofcharm.com. They moved us over to Sirius 108. Are you also on 139 or next?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Okay. And so you guys teach, you have a, like, you'll be on 11 o'clock this morning.
Mm-hmm.
You teach a charm show to men.
A charm show.
Mm-hmm. Charm show,
Who did you pitch that to? How did you get the...
You know what? Here? We were doing... an internet radio thing for a while, and we started teaching guys, and somebody here at Sirius decided they needed a little bit of, well, actually,
you were
we were on the internet first, and we came in as a guest on another show, formerly Maxim Radio, and we helped one of the people there and gave a lot of advice there, and so we piqued the interest of the execs.
And then what is the gist of the show? What are you trying to do? What is it?
Well, it's a caller-based show. So people call in, and they have questions, and we answer the questions. And mm-hmm. I mean, we're relationship experts.
Is it mostly people from the building calling you? Because that's what they do here.
Oh, that's, you know, this is the island of misfit toys, this place.
No,
man.
That's what they do here.
Oh,
I know.
When
a new show starts, the building calls. So when I came here, they said, do you want the employees to call your show? I said, no. I said, if I don't get calls, that's my problem.
Dude, that's a great option.
That's a good option. We never got that. We had a bunch of calls. The call board fills up pretty quick because
these big, tough guys out here wanting you to teach them what exactly?
Well, it depends, man. People have different types of relationship problems. Usually, I mean, we get a lot of guys who call in who know what they're doing in the beginning and then don't know how to take care of the interaction later on.
Like, what makes you guys experts?
What makes you qualified to question me?
Well, I have to be honest with you. You just don't look like two cocksmen to me. It's like
two cocksmen.
Why, they're good looking guys.
You know, I don't know. They're not, are they? I don't know.
You know, it's
they're
good.
Nice looking. I mean,
we don't look like douchebags, is what he means.
Well, you know what?
Yeah, we do.
You know what? You don't look like guys that. I mean, you look like you have to work to get laid.
Oh, thanks, man.
Mm-hmm.
We pay, actually. It's a lot easier if you pay.
You know, and you have kind of a
mohawk. Cockatoo.
Yeah.
No, but it isn't a mohawk.
It's a faux hawk.
You've got the hair on the side. It's more like a rooster hawk.
It's a rooster hawk. So you're saying I don't look like a cocksman, yet I have a rooster hawk?
Well, you know what? I don't know what's attractive anymore. Who knows? I can't. You know, people like Tom Waits.
Now you're onto something. You know,
Tom Waits.
Yeah, we're talking about Tom Waits.
I don't know.
Girls find him attractive?
No, they think his songs are meaningful. We were talking about that, and we don't.
They're two totally different things.
Totally. Yeah.
I'm still
stuck on the fact that these guys are helping out dudes on the Maxim show. That pussy falls from the sky for these guys. Like, oh yeah, let's help Rich and Covino out with chicks. They really have a problem.
You know who
with
we helped was we helped. Spotty.
Oh, he's a mess.
Christian.
Good call.
Yeah.
Good call.
Yeah. No, so what does qualify you, honestly?
Well, we got into this. I mean, there's no job description for this. I mean, we had to learn a lot and get brought into this industry. So in the beginning, we were starting out. Jordan was starting out by interviewing people who are relationship experts. And I started out just studying psychology. And at some point,
I would think you'd gotten laid like 10 times in a week, and you go, man, I am good at this. I should start telling people.
Like
how
that guy, Mystery. Yeah. Are you guys like Mystery?
We had Mystery on our show, actually.
He came on our show. We're a little bit different in that we don't use a bunch of fake stuff to get girls.
I don't wear fuzzy hats.
No, fuzzy hats.
I do shave my balls, though.
Yeah, that's for sure. That's mandatory. But the stuff we teach is all natural confidence, so we can teach somebody to be more confident, believe in themselves, and get their stuff together. A lot of people come in looking to get laid, and they end up changing their life, getting a promotion at work, making more money, changing their life around, and then they're like, oh yeah, suddenly I'm more attractive
to girls. They listen to your show.
Absolutely.
And they got a promotion.
They get laid, and they get a promotion.
Yeah, You're on at 11 o'clock
on 108, right?
Absolutely.
And in this terrible economy, the phones are going to just light up for you guys.
That's nice.
Today. So when
shaving balls, who spots and who shaves?
Well, it depends. We have to alternate, obviously.
Obviously. You need two spots.
So Jordan, what like a guy will call up and say what, generally? Not meeting women, don't know where to go?
It runs the whole gamut. Some guys are out of long-term relationships. Some guys are divorced. They don't know where to go to meet girls. Other guys say they meet girls.
No, it's true, the internet.
Well, we do teach online dating. We have guys who wrote a book called Window Shopping for Women.
Mm. And but there's a different breed of woman you're going to find hanging out on the internet.
Not necessarily.
All kinds of breeds.
I'm sorry. Every girl has MySpace and Facebook, so you're meeting normal girls. They just don't. You're flying in under the radar because you're approaching them on MySpace or Facebook.
Well, I think a normal girl on MySpace or Facebook is like a normal girl with like a normal profile picture. Right. When you got a chick who's in the mirror with her fucking leg up on the counter showing moose knuckle, you know, odds are, even though she has a MySpace, she's not a normal.
Maybe
girl.
Maybe I should change my profile picture.
Have to get a hold of my profile.
The phones have already. I want to watch this in action here.
The explosion has begun.
Chris, it's the Jay Thomas Show. Go to theartofcharm.com. Joshua and Jordan are here. They're on at 11 o'clock at Sirius 108. And they dedicated to teaching guys how to meet and attract the women of their dreams. Yes, Chris. Go ahead, Chris.
Yo, dude. You there?
Chris, you there? Go.
1, 2, 3, go.
Chris, Juneau, Alaska. You're on.
Sean, where is he? What could he possibly be doing? You can hear the truck. You can hear him in the cab of the truck.
Parsippany, New Jersey, you're on.
All right. Forget him. Forget
you're
him.
You're hired.
Yeah. All right. All right. So when I, my
we get a lot of questions like that. Actually.
Yeah, there's a lot of.
What about for the ladies?
We teach women too.
We teach women as well. We have female coaches on staff. We have female programs as
on
well.
Staff,
but the
on
coach,
staff, we have a big staff.
Yeah,
but the coach.
We run
what?
A company besides
what is
the show.
What is it that you coach? I don't quite
well, give
get.
Them a scenario.
Are you like be confident and hot? Go,
yeah,
bitch.
Ready to go.
Tell me a little bitch.
There's a lot of body language and eye contact stuff involved. There's a lot of what you call subliminal communication. There's a lot of nonverbal communication.
What is it? Nonverbal
communication. For example, if you see a guy slouching over in the corner with a drink in front of his chest, he looks scared.
Right.
He doesn't really look confident. But if you see a normal guy standing there talking to his friends looking really relaxed, it's a different story. So women pick up on those things and say, okay, that guy over
those
there.
Those guys are arrogant.
He looks attractive. Well, maybe
you're still attracted
a lot
to
of
him.
Yeah,
I
you're
like
still attracted.
The guy in the corner.
Yeah, you like the guy in the corner? Well, thanks for bringing your roommate, by the way.
I can remember.
Appreciate you bringing your roommate.
Going to a town, you know, by myself. This happens. You're working or whatever. You go to town by yourself.
Uh-huh.
And there's a bar up the street. And you see a bunch of people in the bar. And you go in and you're by yourself. And you put your nice clothes on. And you have a drink and you stand at the bar. And there's women all over the place.
Right. Yeah.
And, you know, you're confident, and then you're there alone for 2 or 3 hours.
Wow.
And then you leave. But you're supposed to, like, just, what, take
oh, dude, there's so many situations in that. In,
take
in
a
that
drink
scenario.
Over, or?
Well, typically when you go into a place like that, if you have no what's
a nice
called,
place. A nice place.
Sure. A lounge or whatever.
Whatever, yeah.
Well, you know? So you have no social value in that situation.
None.
So you have to create some.
Mm-hmm.
You have to make yourself valuable.
Yeah, it's easy, though.
To the women. Oh, it is.
Yeah, okay. Because what people perceive valuable in you.
Well, I'm standing like I'm at the bar right now. In fact, I'm erect. You know,
hey. Too much information.
Some nice clothes on. Uh-huh. I have a bracelet that has it looks like money. I have a Rolex. I have my cocktail, and I just stand. You know,
well, that's your first mistake.
You never just stand there.
Yeah,
you always have to be speaking to someone if you can. So look, if you're introducing your. Are you
so
okay
I
with
don't
this?
Know anybody. Though.
That's okay. It doesn't
That's
matter.
All right.
So no
you,
one knows that.
So
no
I go like
you
this.
Know anybody.
Hey, so here's the guy, surely. But now, hey,
how about them Saints? You walk up to somebody.
Hey, you know, what do you say? Yes, some stupid question. Hey, is there a sports bar in here?
I don't typically don't ask stupid questions.
Yeah. What
but
do you
then
do?
I would turn to you and I'd go, dude, I'm not gay. Back off.
All right. What? So
but
what
no,
do you
see,
do?
Here's the thing. Even if you said that,
right.
No one sees that happening. All they see is you talking to a guy they think you know. So if you do this to the bartender. Everyone else who's watching you thinks you know the bartender, automatically gives you more social proof.
So what you're pretending.
What if I pull up to the bar, right?
You're pretending.
And check it out. Jay's over here.
You laughed, but what are you doing? You're pretending.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Like, what if I lip sync a fake conversation with you? Like, I'm not even looking at you, and there's a bunch of, and I'm just like,
if it looks
that,
like you're talking to yourself,
that works
really
well.
You're going to attract a certain kind of woman.
Yeah, that's why bums are so hot.
I'm going to attract a woman talking to herself at the other end of the bar.
But don't you think that going to a bar out to a social situation like that with the intention is kind of
oh yeah,
it's
wait, kind I'd
of
never,
gay.
I'd
you
never
should just go out to have a good time.
Yeah, absolutely.
With your people,
but you have
and
to
not
meet.
Try.
No, you're by yourself.
But when you're
you have
not
to meet.
Try, when, then don't go by yourself.
You have to.
You can. You have to by yourself. Yeah, it doesn't matter.
First
yeah.
of
Look,
all, I've never. Hey, I've never in my life. Hung with a group of people, and I traveled.
Well, you're
all
good.
Time.
It's. I think it's really different for men. I think men can go to bars by themselves and just like you know Norm from Cheers. He was the quintessential guy. He just went to. The
we base. We base all of our psychology off
really
Norm from Cheers.
Yeah.
Actually, so that makes total
do
sense.
Do you really?
No.
Way to bring up Jay's Vietnam,
really?
Madison.
Ouch.
You know what? Every time I do go, you know, and I'll usually go into an upscale bar. I'm from New Orleans. There's a lot of people going to bars.
Sure.
I do see a single woman usually sitting at the bar, maybe waiting for a girlfriend or whatever, and she'll have a cocktail in front of her. Mm-hmm. And, you know, guys will want to talk and all, but they're wondering, is a guy coming? So do you go over, because you don't want to waste any time.
Well, right. Guys are also wondering how much does she charge? Why
no,
is she here
no,
by
no,
herself?
No. But if she's sitting alone, she's attractive, you and your buddy will go, gee, what do you think that's about? So do you just go over and go, what's that about?
Well, I typically don't say what's that about, but... But you don't want to hesitate, that's for damn sure. I mean, you don't want to sit around and go...
She's waiting for a guy, right?
What are you worried about, though? Who cares if she's waiting for a guy? A lot of
times, but that's Jay. He overanalyzes.
Yeah, you don't
want to
over. You're getting inside your head. We call that where you're thinking, okay, yeah, Jay, what's the worst situation that can happen? I don't want that to happen. You're going to try and avoid consequences that aren't even real by doing that. Mm. So if you just walk up to a girl and you say, "Hi, my name is Jay," she'll introduce herself. Eventually, she'll say, "Yeah, I'm just waiting for my friend." It doesn't matter.
Can I buy you a drink while you're waiting?
No, I never do that.
Don't do that.
Why not?
Okay.
That implies that she's a whore.
Negative.
No, I don't know. I just
you know
that
what?
That
I have good. To tell you, I don't know where you meet women. You had to be terrible at it.
Let me tell you something. On stage, I'm Godzilla. Yeah. I'm not scared of any broad.
I'm going to break
off stage.
I haven't been on a stand-up stage in years. Last night, looking down at these gorgeous, you know, women.
Women
want
to fuck a stand-up.
And they're all looking at you, and you can see them. And you are looking down past your penis down at them. It was so powerful feeling.
Yeah, you
said
it as a sight, though, you know?
No, and you know what? So, but that's different. Then you can meet them in your inn, right? These are guys walking into a place, woman sitting by herself. What do you say? How do you, a guy's going to come eventually, or her girlfriend.
Well, nice legs. What time do they open?
Oh!
You know what, Shirley?
You working with UPS? Because I saw you checking out my package. I wish you were a door so I could bang you all
right.
Day long. All right.
Obviously, these are bad ideas.
These are great.
He's not even looking at a screen. He's just got them all memorized.
He's pulling these straight out of his ass.
So before we go to a relationship call, what would you suggest? The woman is alone. What do you say?
Well...
How do you?
It probably depends.
If you don't
want
to buy her a drink, what's your move?
Right. Well, let me tell you why you shouldn't buy a drink, though.
Go ahead.
That's important.
Go ahead. What?
So, okay.
Why are you fucking laughing?
Because
you know what?
The kid's high. What are you killing his eye for?
You know what? Let me ask you a question. There's a woman at a bar by herself.
Mm-hmm.
There's an attractive guy, single. He's there. I've asked you 5 friggin' times. What do you say to the woman? I go, generally, you go buy a drink and you're doing this.
He's getting emotional.
Are you kidding me? You know what? Let me tell you what I would do. Okay. If you walked in, I'd go, if you're with this little fag, when you want to be with a man, watch this. Here's my number.
Right.
And by the way, if he doesn't like it, tell him I'll kick his ass. Those are the bars
I
go.
That's way better than saying I'll buy you a drink.
But hold it a second.
I agree.
By the way, I see you're in here with your brother, okay? When you put him to bed, give me a call.
Wow.
If she's with an older guy,
that's good too, dude.
You go over and go,
I see
you're with your dad, right? Okay, now I did that myself.
Hey, that's good.
You're over here laughing, but no, that's a tax.
Well, you're not letting him answer. Go ahead. What would you do?
He wasn't. He was going,
just spit it out.
All right, so the reason why you don't buy a drink typically is because you're doing what's called buying value. So... people, whenever we go up and we meet somebody else in a bar, especially if we don't know them yet, we place a certain value on them. So if it's a really hot girl and we're not used to a really beautiful woman. Yep.
Shirley, what value do you put on a female human being by themselves at a bar?
Anything on the 59-cent Taco Bell menu. All
right. So anyway, a lot of guys see hot girls and they think they don't deserve them. So they try to buy time by buying them a drink so they spend time with them. That's why women typically spend time with them after a little while.
That's why a lot of them go to the bars. They get free drinks from guys who...
A lot of
them
will.
Sometimes, yeah. If you look at the gold digger mentality, those girls are with those guys because they're buying them stuff.
Right.
So it's the same thing on a smaller scale. And we're not saying that every girl's a gold digger, but what we are
You can say that.
I'd rather not. But what we are saying is that if you do go up and you buy her a drink, you're putting her in that mentality right away. Why do that if she's not really already there?
So what do you just say? Like, hey.
You tell him, go make me food.
Hey, sweetie.
How about a steak?
You don't have to roll in and be sleazy. A lot of people seem to think that you've got to roll up and have a line like Shuli had earlier, but you don't need that at all.
Yeah, I wouldn't recommend that.
I would love that, Shuli. If a guy like you came up to me with a line, I would laugh my ass off.
Right, but
I would stick my tongue down your throat. Immediately.
So if you want to get Madison, you know exactly, you get the formula laid out right here.
You're pretty easy.
Well, I'm a slut.
I'd walk up to Madison and go, how about a meat lover's pizza and some anal sex?
I would
love
that.
And then when she'd freak out, I'd go, you don't like meat?
Pizza.
All right, here we go. Let's go to Dan of St. Louis. Dan, the Jay Thomas Show. These guys will be on 108 at 11 o'clock. And I apologize for the tough love you heard.
A few
moments ago.
Man, I got issues.
Joshua and Jordan, go to theartofcharm.com. Yes, Dan of St. Louis, what's your question?
Well, my question is, I'm driving here listening, and it's a fairly interesting conversation, but between you and Shuli and that gal that you got in there, you won't let these...
Thank you.
you guys won't let these guys talk. Shut the fuck up and let them say what they want to say.
I just did let him talk. He said you can't give a value to the woman.
No, you interrupt. You interrupt them constantly, Jay.
And what are you doing? Are you not interrupting us at this moment?
Dan, let me apologize to you.
Surely you're just talking, and they're all talking over you. Right. I mean, you guys at no pace to
but
the
show
at all.
That's Jay's way. That's just how it is.
No pace.
You are listening to ADD Radio.
Right.
And if that's not cool,
Dan,
got it nailed down.
What is your relationship question for Jordan and for Joshua, who are on Game On at 11 o'clock on 108? What's your question?
I got no question. I tell you to shut the fuck up and let them talk to people.
All right, so it's more of a comment.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thanks for the call.
Nothing like constructive criticism.
Say it. Okay. All right. We'll do exactly what he said.
Okay.
Boy, not much of a show.
Alrighty. Let's start doing that. Okay, let's scratch that and try a new one.
Welcome to Game On.
Welcome to the
Have you ever heard my show? It's probably the most hated show on Sirius.
Really?
Oh, perfect.
Wow.
Dude.
Good.
I like what we can argue in here and no one cares.
Yeah, that's nice. Let's go to Chris of New Jersey, the Jay Thomas Show. The guys, artofcharm.com, Game On at Sirius 108. Yes, go ahead, Chris of New Jersey.
Jay, first question, Jay. Were you on like Jeopardy or something as like a video bonus question?
No, Millionaire. I was an expert on Millionaire.
Millionaire, that's right. I saw you. I can kick your ass. I just wanted to make sure. Look, you saw,
I got to tell you. Last night it was all roses. This morning,
it's all shit.
It's like,
Welcome back to fertilizer.
Yeah, sure.
Shut the fuck up like that last guy said. Let me ask my question.
Oh, my God.
I walk into bars, man. I mostly go out. I look to get into fights. I look for the toughest fucking guy in the bar. I want to stare him down. Mm-hmm. And I want him to look at me the wrong fucking way, so I say, let's step outside.
Right.
Other than going up to a guy and spitting his fucking face or headbutting him in the bar, what's the next fastest way to kick the fucking shit out of him outside in an alley?
You know what? I'm going to give it to a guy that's never been in a fight. Jordan, take it.
How you doing? I wouldn't be in a fight with you, man. I've got the rooster tail haircut. You wouldn't even bother with me, I don't think.
Have you ever been threatened in a bar?
Have I been threatened at a bar?
Oh,
no,
I have.
Not doing this.
I had a guy say he was going to take my life once.
I used to be a bouncer, and I was a bodyguard for a while in Detroit. I actually used to be 209 pounds. Right now, I'm like 170, so you get a picture of how much bigger I used to be. So, yeah, I used to get in fights. I used to actually fight people for money, if you look at it that way. And
come on. I fought MMA. You're a filthy fucking heave, aren't you?
Fucking fight. That depends. What day is it today?
You know what? I got to tell you
something.
Got
to bring the Jew thing in.
This is really one of the worst holiday shows I've ever
seen. Spirit's not just
horrible.
Not there. But I think you answered your own question. That's a great
can
way to
I
get
just
you
say,
throwing that stuff around.
Can I just say, everything took a hard left when these guys came on, all right? And there was a
What's
lot of love
with us?
In here.
Is this our fault?
You know I what I really, so. You know what I enjoyed a lot more? The silence. Now that they're calling, I know how they really feel.
Oh, back when man. You could fill in the blanks yourself, you figured listener satisfaction was at an all-time
All right.
Did anybody get, was it Kike Heeb Kike, or what did he end on? Thank you, Master.
Okay, Dan of New York. Yes, sir, go ahead.
Hey, I want to say the same thing the first Dan said. Shut the fuck up and let these guys answer the question. You started off the question where single guy walks into the bar, what does he do? What
all right.
does he talk to? Answer the question. All they didn't right. answer the question.
All right.
Holy shit.
Jesus. Do you have a question, Dan?
All right, Dan. What? Yeah, you want to know.
Question,
go ahead.
My question is the same thing that Jay said. I walk into a bar. I'm single, I'm by myself, I'm in another state, and what do I do to attract the girl's attention when I have no idea who anybody is?
All right, so here's the deal. Thanks for asking that question, and finally someone asked a question. Now, I'm thinking, listen, whenever you go into a bar, like I was saying earlier, and if you don't know anybody, and Jordan and I have done this, I mean, it's endless the amount of times that we've done this, and we've had guys, we teach guys, and take them out, actually, in field, quote-unquote. To meet girls, and whenever they go in, they don't know anybody. So the number one thing you need to do, a lot of guys shy away from talking to other dudes. This is a big mistake. If you can win over guys in the bar, you'll be able to meet women a lot easier. If the dudes like you. Now, if you're going in and getting fights like the last dude called in, then you're not going to have a very good easy time meeting women. That's how it is. But ultimately, you want to talk to the bartender, the waitress.
Beat up a Heeb.
Yeah. walk in, find the biggest Jew, beat his ass.
I got now. So now I have to adjust my picking up women skills to hitting on guys first.
Yeah, really important.
Hey, dude, you work out?
Nice
what's
ass.
Going on?
So ultimately,
you just kind of become friendly with the guys.
At the biggest mistake the guys make is they go straight to seduction, which is the final stage of an interaction.
Do you know what I think they're really asking? What would you say? Forget women. What would you say to a guy? It's a bunch of guys sitting there, strangers. You got a drink in front of you. What do you say? You have to have a question.
If you're walking around, you don't have to ask people questions. You don't even have to. You can do that if you want to, but it starts when you walk into the venue. For example, when we go into the bar, I usually try to skip the line. It doesn't matter if I know anybody there. I'll greet the doorman, say, hey, what's up, man? You staying warm? That kind of stuff. Nobody talks to the doorman. When I worked at the door in Detroit, nobody said a damn thing to me. I was like furniture. Door guys, they're bored as hell. It's cold, especially now here in New York. You greet the doorman, you roll in, you banter a little bit with the person who takes the ticket or the coat check. It doesn't matter. You can introduce yourself to those people. Then it looks like you know them and you come there all the time. People around you are going to start to notice that. Now, when you walk into the bar, if you go to the bar and grab your drink and you're bantering with the bartender, now you get a drink. You see a guy next to you, you say, hey, man, Evan, good night. If he's just sitting there bored as hell, he's going to start talking to you because the guys who are sitting at the bar not talking to anybody, you know they're looking around for girls. They know that they look awkward and they feel awkward. If you start talking to them, they feel more at ease. Everybody around you starts to notice that people are loosening up around you. People notice that you have higher social value. So if you do that to a lot of people in the bar, they're going to introduce you to girls. Girls are going to start introducing themselves to you.
But isn't there a danger where you go up to that guy at the bar and you're like, how you doing tonight? And he turns to you and goes, my wife left me.
I've had that before, dude.
It happens very rarely.
But it doesn't matter anyway. You just go, all right, man, well, look on the bright side.
Because you don't want to be...
See, I guess I'm looking for that opening question, a sports question.
Yeah, but I don't use those.
I don't think you need to use questions.
So what you're
you
saying is everybody's probably in the same situation.
A lot of people
you're
are,
in.
Yeah.
Sure, right. A lot of people are.
Misery likes company. So you don't open up with, hey, is there any pussy around here?
Right. you don't want to walk in.
I'm coming in looking to get laid. What's happening? You know?
You don't want to walk in like man on the street interview, too, where you're like, you know.
Okay.
If you would come all back right. as a tree, what tree would you be?
All right. Dan in New York, is that who did better? Okay, good. Thanks. It is the J. Thomas Show. Joshua Pellant. Is it Pellissier?
Pellissier.
Pellissier and Jordan Harbinger, theartofcharm.com, and then at 11 o'clock this morning, you'll call up on 108, and they'll be Victor of Long Island. Yes, sir. Go ahead, Victor.
How you guys doing?
Good.
Guys, I want to comment. The guys are talking about going in and talking to the bartender and a place like that's the way to go, man. You got to work the people at work that you're talking about, the doorman, you know, and stuff like that. That's certainly what I do. You know, that's why I want to comment. I don't have a lot to say other than those guys are 100% right as far as if you're walking in by yourself, you know, making friends with the bartender, making some people laugh. And then just
have you ever done this? Have you ever done, hey, man, where do you score some coke around here?
No. Well, dude, that's another thing. No, you don't go in asking questions. I mean, there's always a TV on or a song on or something or some girl's dancing funny. Always, you can make a comment on
oh, you
on
know what? Look at her.
Observation.
Look at that idiot.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. All right.
If I dance like that.
Yeah, you don't go in and asking, like, questions. I mean, right away, you're putting someone on the spot, like the guy said before, what if the guy starts crying or whatever? But I'm just saying, yeah, you can goof on somebody else that's in the bar with somebody.
Well, that's
that
kind of negative,
know.
Though.
No,
I just picture Jay walking up going, favorite president, off top of your head.
All right, going, what? Thank you.
I'm in radio.
Burger King has announced that they are selling a new body spray. This is not a joke. It's called the Hint of Flame Broiled Meat.
Oh.
They're calling it Flame. It is a men's body spray. And they are describing it as the scent of seduction with a hint of this flame-broiled meat.
That's true. I put some on this morning, and like 30 fat chicks were chasing me down.
If you go to their website,
and dogs.
There's a photo of the king character reclining in his fireside naked, and except for an animal that is placed on his lap. So you can't. It's a marketing ploy, but they're actually at Burger King selling... Burger King is also in the midst of its Whopper Virgins campaign that features the taste test for the fast food virgins and stuff. Would you ever spray some Burger King flame?
I'm not a big fan. I mean, I love the taste of the Whopper, but I don't know if I need to smell like it all day. And I think that happens automatically once you eat one anyway.
Yeah, right. For about 17
it's
hours.
It's cheaper just
to you would one. Go outside where the smoke comes out of the big chimney out in the back, and you stand there. But you'd spray. You'd go, excuse me, you know, meet some, excuse me, go to Matt. I'm trying a new, you know. What do I? Can you give me a list a little? Would you do something
dude,
like that?
That's just repulsive.
No, you wouldn't do that. You wouldn't go.
I think it's funny
I'm
though.
Trying a new scent.
I definitely do it.
What do I smell like? You know, you're like
that's a good one for a girl.
You're like
too,
flame like, broiled.
tested out his new protein.
We need to get a sweaty ball scent or something.
Yeah, it's the next best thing, though, the flame broiled whopper. Sweaty balls is one of the ingredients.
Eau de sweat.
It's probably the main
ingredient. What's some of the advice you give to girls who are waiting for a friend in a bar?
Give it up.
Yeah, that's
it. Early and often. Two fists in it. Do it.
Wear a low cut top.
Do it.
DVDA.
Oh, jeez. I don't even know what that means.
Well, double vaginal, double anal.
Okay.
These guys can't answer. We don't let them talk.
That's okay. We don't need to. Okay. We do this all day.
So the woman sitting by herself, mm-hmm. poor thing, waiting for
poor
somebody.
Thing. Poor darling.
Poor darling, sitting by herself. Do you give advice to women, too, or they're just some meat on the hook waiting at the waiting at the station, right?
And I think the biggest problem with women is well, mm-hmm. we get things mixed up.
That's a good beginning.
Yeah. Biggest problem with women, well, let me tell you about it.
Pretty sharp
and it's
answer.
Just one?
They have
it's
vaginas.
Only one. Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, that's the biggest problem. Mm-hmm. Women have what's called a filtering mechanism. Guys have an approach mechanism, which means we need to go approach women. That's what we do. And when we do it well, we're considered to be attractive men. And women have what's called a filtering mechanism, which filters out weak men. Mm. And when they do it well, we think that when they're more attractive women, they seem higher value. So the biggest problem with women is that they filter out the wrong qualities that guys know how to fake. This is a really big problem. And that's why a lot of players can get past a lot of women's barriers, because they use rapport, which is connection, to fake confidence. And they get in. And the women never see it coming, ever.
Exactly. So, for example, the girls who are like, I'm a bitch when I go out to the bar. That's fine. But I know that the arrogant guys are the ones that she's after. Because the arrogant guy doesn't give a rat's ass if she's going to be a bitch. Because he's not listening to anything she's saying.
He's into himself.
So it doesn't matter. So you can be the biggest, you can have the biggest great wall in front of you. You can act like a total bitch at the bar. But it doesn't matter. Because the guys who don't care about that, because they're not going to be dealing with you anyway, they just want to sleep with you, they're going to ignore that completely. Now, a confident guy would go in, and a guy who has a decent sense of self-esteem would go in, and if she's screening too hard, he's going to be like, you know what, never mind, it's not that important. Or he'll just ignore it if he's just trying to get laid. So women are screening out the wrong qualities. They'll screen for a guy, for example, if they're looking for a guy who has money, they'll immediately start saying, what kind of car do you drive? You heard this from L.A. If you guys have been to L.A., that happens a lot. They're screening for a lot of that stuff.
Yeah.
And so they're going to screen.
They don't even know they're screening.
No, they're unconsciously doing it.
Oh, they know.
A lot of them in L.A. know.
Yeah, the women in L.A. who are looking for a guy with money, they know. But certain
A lot of girls,
for example, here, they have no idea that they're just thinking, oh, well, I'm kind of difficult because I don't know why this guy's talking to me. And a lot of that has to do with their past relationships, guys who've hurt them in the past. They lump a lot of guys together. It's a subconscious process. So it happens a lot.
It's amazing to me that the guys that make out in the bars are the ones that seem like the one, like if I was a woman, the guys you see doing well, you go, What is with this this schmuck?
It's usually a person. Honestly, it's personality. Like last night at the stand-up show, there were a couple comedians who I did not find attractive on first sight. After their act, I was madly in love. I was ready
to suck a dick.
But
that's on stage. That's a whole
different... It doesn't matter. Personality will do it for you.
I mean, look at Shuley.
Totally.
If you weren't a comedian or on radio...
Oh, stop.
I mean, when you were pushing a wheelchair in Vegas, that's what this is for.
He had a girlfriend then.
Yeah, but she was from Vietnam.
Yeah, it was a green card.
Thailand
or whatever.
Whatever.
I mean,
she's the enemy. That's all we know.
I mean, you get in show business, it's a lot easier, right?
Absolutely.
It gives you an automatic confidence.
Yeah, but personality has a lot to do
when you walk in, you have an automatic confidence.
Because you know no matter what, you're Jay Thomas.
No, you're going home, and you're going home with yourself, who you love more than anybody anyway.
Oh, yeah. That's a good strategy.
That's a good outlet.
When you were pushing the wheelchair in the airport,
sure.
Did you have no confidence in yourself?
It's a little tough when you're wearing a vest and
but you were funny, Shuley. You had a good personality, and you're a good person.
Yeah.
Well, that doesn't really help you close a deal with a piece of
that. That's not true at all. You'll see attractive women with not attractive men all the time.
Of course. I saw exhibiting certain personality traits that are going to get by that. Shuley doesn't necessarily have a problem with that. I don't know you very well, obviously, but it seems to me if you go in with the same confidence you have on the radio and like the self-deprecating humor, which you get by, you're obviously an expert at that. A lot of women are going to dig that, especially if you own it.
You got to cut it out.
This guy's a goddamn genius.
Let's go to Dick.
Although I find with my self-deprecating humor, it has driven many boyfriends crazy.
Yeah, that's quite the opposite for you.
Yeah.
Take it. If you don't trust it,
I don't trust this call. Dick of Tampa. Joshua and Jordan, theartofcharm.com at 11 o'clock this morning on Sirius 108 or XM 139. Game on. Yes, go ahead, Dick of Tampa.
No, it's six.
It's Sticks. Oh, well, then
no, Sticks.
like a Nikki Six, jackass.
Oh, six.
I just wanted your guys' opinion on something, seriously. But I just want to say, hey, Shuley, I saw you at the Lakeland show, man, the one where Sal fell off the stage.
Oh, that was a brutal show.
yeah, you fucking bombed there, too, dude.
Yeah. So listen, it was rough, man.
Listen, I got this situation. I'll make it quick. I was going out with this girl for 3.5 years. Mm-hmm. She moved down here from Kentucky. And during our whole relationship, she's had this ex-husband.
Oh, my God.
Well, listen, no. He has full custody of the kids, and he basically would never let her see the kids the whole time and threatened her. They said, you cannot see the fucking kids unless you move up here.
You may want to call the Martha Stewart channel.
Well, listen, 2 weeks ago, she hauled ass and went back up there and caved in, and now she wants me to come up there.
Nope.
I'm going to go visit her next Friday. Am I doing the right thing by
Here, I think you should wait for when you guys all get called up to do the Springer show, and then you guys can rendezvous there.
Park
your house in the parking lot, put it in park, and go in and do the show.
Hey, Six, you do not want to be with a woman who has these redneck kids from Kentucky.
She's got baggage.
Buddy, listen.
Surely everybody has baggage, and everyone deserves
love.
That's not right.
You don't
want to
be...
Guys.
You guys don't think I should go up there?
No.
It's not the kids. It's not the kids, man.
It's the friggin' kids.
No, man. You're totally off on that, man.
What?
You're way off. It's not the kids.
You know what a lion does?
It's the fact
when
that
a lion,
the ex-husband
hey,
sees
when
the kids
a lion
control,
beats
I'm gonna get
the other lions,
tell him, Jay.
Other lion's leader, he kills all of the cubs.
You're right.
So go kill some kids.
Unless the kids die, don't go to Kentucky. You don't want to have some other guy's spooge children.
Stop it. You don't want.
And
number two, it's Kentucky.
Do you really hate yourself that
much?
Wait,
so you would just be visiting? You would just be visiting?
Yeah, we're going to try to work something. She wants me to come up there. We're actually going to meet in Nashville.
First of all, honestly, what kind of woman just leaves her children is what I'm trying to figure out.
The husband has full custody, so she didn't really have... She didn't really have access to the kids.
Full custody.
If you're a woman who loses your kids, then
I was just gonna, any woman
then you're a piece of shit. Yeah.
What's that,
you're
Paul?
A piece of shit.
Any woman that
Paul microphones.
Yes.
That's what
no. Any
courts always award.
Yeah.
We have a guy walking down the hall, comes in and begins broadcasting.
Bitter, angry,
a bitter, angry married man.
That's how we run shit.
Yeah.
Hey, Jay, before I go, did I mention that Shuley bombed in Lakeland?
Yeah. In front of 4,000 people. And let me tell you something. When they wrote out my check at the end of that night, it didn't say bombed on it.
All right.
Thanks.
Hey, guys. Fuck off, Shuley.
All right. Go fuck your mother. Have a good day. Right.
Hey, man, he remembered you, Shuley. That's what counts.
It's
they
the
all
Jay
remember.
Thomas Show. Howard 101.
Howard 101.
Go to jthomas.com. The holiday shirt that everybody wants is Merry Christmas. Got a problem with that? There you go. Also, we want to thank all the Jews for killing our Savior, so we're going to have this incredible sales event. Those are the two big T-shirts.
Jay, allow me to say, you're welcome.
My pleasure.
On behalf of all of us.
Look for me Tuesday night with David Letterman. I will be on the Late Show with David Letterman on Tuesday night, telling the story I tell every year, throwing the football. And doing all of that. Shuley, where are you this weekend? Any place?
I'll be at home this weekend, relaxing.
Last night, we're at Caroline's at a big night. Madison will be on Alt Nation 21 later on. Okay.
Oh, can I just mention, though, at the end of December, December 27th in Toronto, I'll be opening for Dice Clay.
Big deal.
And the 28th in Montreal, opening for Dice Clay. Go to jewgonewild.com for ticket info.
Joshua Pellicer, is that it? By saying
that's right.
Thank you. And Jordan Harbinger, go to theartofcharm.com. Or you can listen to him at 11 o'clock at Sirius 108, XM 139. In a few minutes, we'll give you a chance at winning $5,000 by making an erotic film. We'll have a guy on from the AVN Film Fest. It's an erotic film, but you can't depict any ejaculate, urine, or feces. I don't know how good
the
film
is. Then how is it erotic?
I don't know either. But
if I don't see that, I'm not getting turned on.
Can you show titty?
You can have a close-up shot of vagina, penis, and anus. Oh, no. Even the close-up of the vagina, the penis, and the anus will not be permitted.
I mean, Jesus, what happened to all the fun?
I don't. You know what? It's $5,000.
It's just breasts, then.
I don't. You know what? It's like a Playboy Channel thing.
You have to make a Cinemax movie.
Softcore.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, they're going to give away like $4,000 and a production contract.
What happened to $5,000?
Well, I took a grade. I took 20%.
You did, didn't you?
All right. Well, I have a video with none of those things in it. It's me and my girlfriend bicycling through.
Perfect, dude.
Yeah.
You know, you can show man tits.
We just had a guy call up and tell us that he hangs out at the women's bathroom.
By the women's bathroom.
Yeah, by the women's bathroom.
At a bar, yeah.
This guy caught our show, too.
Yeah, and totally. He said that he waits for the drunks to go in and out, and then that's who he hits on. Are you saying to men, we're teaching you how to get laid in a bar or how to meet somebody nice? If you want to get laid, is that a good idea to watch the drunks going in and out of the ladies' bathroom?
I mean, I guess it depends what you're looking for. That's pretty low-hanging fruit. I mean, if you're going to go for the drunk girls by the women's bathroom, then you're just playing a numbers game. But obviously, if you're looking for anything more than that, than a drunken, nasty, probably regrettable hookup, then you're playing the wrong game by hanging out by the women's bathroom. But that's just sleazy. Really, that's gross.
You know, I have never been a drunk screwer, you know?
Wait a minute, did you just say it was sleazy and gross?
Yeah.
Yeah, so you'd be
in a good way.
So you're saying that it's sleazy for a lion on the plains of the Serengeti
to hang out by the women's
bathroom. To attack a wounded antelope or a gazelle.
Wild,
because that's what we're doing.
I brought up the lion thing earlier, so you're going back to nature.
This is an animal planet.
This is what I know.
Now here you are, Madison, surrounded by like 25 men talking about
sexy men.
Picking women up. When you're in the bar, right, and you're looking for somebody, right?
She's not going to admit that.
Not these days. Not for in a bar.
Where do you go?
Match.com.
I don't. You don't go anywhere right now.
You just stay home.
That's a bad place to meet men.
That's just a terrible place. Staying home.
I think I found your problem.
I'll tell you what her problem. She has the worst choice in men. She finds the weirdest fucking guys.
I do?
Look who she's hanging out with right now, dude.
How about the guy who just wanted to shoot a load on your feet? Remember that?
Oh, yeah.
Remember that? Keeper?
Then there was a cop.
Then there was the guy who fell asleep while you went down on him. Remember that?
In the vice squad.
Yes. What about the guy with the stinky cock from England?
Oh, thank you. I rest my case,
but
Your Honor.
I sucked it anyway. I lit some candles and I sucked away.
Because she's a trooper, and that's why we love her.
High five.
You are a trooper.
You know what? That's who you meet at Mahoney's Pub. You know, the guy.
I go for a hilarious personality or just super hot.
Or stinky cock.
Or stinky dick.
Carl.
Did it stink like Burger King flamethrower?
It stunk like dead rat feces and spoiled milk.
Maybe you should.
That's actually the McDonald's fragrance.
I can imagine somebody just
smelled it all night, and then once I took off his pants, I was like, oh, hell no.
That's it?
And then you did it anyway.
Let me tell you, it smelled
He was English. He was like, suck it.
It smelled so bad that the SWAT team throws his cock into a house to clear it now.
He's like, keep sucking it. I sniffed a candle.
You know what's a good place to meet guys for you? PC Richards. Go try that out. Maybe.
You're just about to eat your Egg McMuffin and Madison's disgusting.
And I sucked that stinky cock like a trooper.
Shut up.
Carl of New Hampshire, Joshua and Jordan are here. TheArtOfCharm.com at 11 o'clock. They'll be on Sirius 108 XM 139 at Game On. Yes, sir. Go ahead. Carl of New Hampshire.
Jay, Shirley, Madison, happy holidays, everybody.
Thank you.
Listen, fascinating guest here. All the diagrams and schematics and manuals for picking up rods, that's fantastic. Or you could come to New Hampshire where half the state hasn't had power for 9 days. And if you've got a fucking operating light bulb and a cup of warm water, you're going to have all the pussy you fucking want.
Ladies and gentlemen, Carl.
Bravo.
That says it all, doesn't it?
Thank you very much. Bravo. Thank you very much. Well, Joshua and Jordan, thank you. Good luck. Go to theartofcharm.com, 11 o'clock. They'll be on 108 or 139 at XM. Joshua, you with a woman now?
I am, yeah. Not right this second. I mean,
but did you meet her using the idea?
Oh yeah, Oh, yeah.
How long have you been together?
A little over a year I've been together. And she was actually a friend of an old client of mine. So I went to his birthday party after he was...
A client of what? You have a charm school?
Yeah, for my course.
They call them clients because loser is not a nice word.
Yeah, it's not a very good word.
Now, the art of charm...
don't like that very much.
We hold...
You mean the unlayable.
Right.
You'd be surprised. A lot of our clients are Abercrombie models. They're just trying... They just have issues or they're models.
A lot of them.
Well, yeah. A lot of our clients are guys you would never expect.
What do you charge? And do you have a woman, Jordan? Or
I'm single because it's fun, and I think we all know that.
Just floating and doing
it? Yeah, absolutely.
Right. You ever get laid so much that you go, I've got to stop this. It's just not cool. I got to, like, relax not getting laid for a while.
When I first started doing this stuff and I started getting really good at it, it started to become a little bit addicting. So, yeah.
What you just said.
There was a timeout.
It might as well have been in Chinese, what you just said.
No,
I understood none of that.
It only happened
it's
once in my
life. Too much
getting
laid?
It hurts your soul after a while.
Yes,
I was engaged to a guy, and after we broke up, I met 20 guys in 1 year. I went nuts. I worked at Hooters. I fucked all my customers. I worked at a tanning salon. I fucked everyone who tanned. I went crazy.
Right. And
look at you now.
And I felt like shit.
Yeah.
Well, I don't feel that bad.
I don't know if it was
said that.
Soul.
What was that comment? Look at me now.
What?
I don't like you two.
Jordan, she doesn't like you.
That's good.
That's a
good sign.
No, what I mean
is that
a lot of friends
just
of mine,
hand jobs.
A lot of buddies of mine, I have, you know, actor friends and all, and they get laid constantly. Right. And I feel as though that the more you get laid, the less you think of women as time goes on.
Yeah,
and it's a lot harder to decide you want to be with someone because they're all no good if they screwed you.
That's basically. A good question. Actually, I have a question. Is that the same for women? The more you get laid, the less you think of guys?
I'm sorry, what?
Is that the same for women? The more you get laid, the less you think about fucking guys?
She's a good listener.
Yeah.
She's on the same page.
I don't know.
Different books.
I'm just very disappointed.
And
well, you know what?
And those two.
Kind of sucked all the fun out of the room, you know? After she sucked the English guy, sucked all the fun out of the room. Right. Joshua and Jordan, thanks very much.
Yeah, man, thank
good
you.
Luck. We're all together on 108 and 139 over there. Very good. Very good. Thank you.
Thank you. We ought to go to these guys from time to time.
You and I?
Yeah. No, I'm just mean for the radio show. I don't need help with broads, dude. Okay.
We should go to them every
I'm
now
a pro.
And again. Okay.
Yeah, you know? All right. Like something big in the news happens, you know? These
we'll
could be our go-to guys.
You mean relationship?
Live via satellite from this hallway.
All right, guys, man. It's during 101. Yes, Jay of Vermont, the Jay Thomas Show. Yes, sir. How are you? Thank you, man. It was fun.
Hey, how's it going?
We're good. Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was wondering if Ira could tell me what the weather is.
Ladies and gentlemen, no better way to bring Ira the weatherman on, but thank you, Jay of Vermont. People actually...
Good morning, Jay.
There he is, Ira the weatherman.
Ira, sing.
There's no sun up in the sky.
Right.
Stormy weather.
Well, if you're 80 years old in a wheelchair, here's your... Here's your guy right here.
Here,
Harry Connick.
Jay of Vermont wants to know, when is the horrible storm going to begin, Ira?
It's beginning today.
What time?
We're supposed to get between 5 and 8 inches.
Wow, where?
New York City area.
Now, what about in Vermont, where Jay is?
Vermont, around 8 inches.
My God.
Madison will have 5 inches in her back door later.
Now, you know what? I guess no one. Do you put chains on tires, Jay, anymore? Do you do that?
Yes, you do.
You have no idea.
Did you call him Jay?
No, I'm talking to Jay of Vermont.
Oh.
Jay, do you put chains on tires? What precautions do you take for 8 inches?
Not so much anymore. Mostly everybody runs studs.
Studs. You have a little stud. So do you have to change the tires out? Have you already done that? You ready to go?
Yeah, of course. You got to be up there. Too much snow.
All right. And then do you have a woman to be with tonight? It'll be the fire going and the whole thing. You have all that ready?
It's nice.
Oh, of course. You got to import them up here, though.
You have to bring them in. This is the second bad news from New England. The Rhode Island's had no electricity, no power, no nothing, and now Vermont. Do you like living there, or would you like to move away to a warmer place?
Sometimes I think about moving to someplace warmer, but it's too nice up here.
Vermont's beautiful.
Mm-hmm. You have a lot of, like, what do they have? They have syrup. There's a lot of syrup there.
Cheese and ice cream.
Wow,
syrup.
That sounds beautiful.
Cows.
Syrup, cheese, and ice cream. Count me in.
And it's 12 below
zero. They change the name to Munchieville while they're at it.
All right, thank you,
Jay. They have
Jay
good weed up there in Vermont. Well,
yeah. Thanks, guys.
All right, there you go. He actually wanted the weather. What do you? I don't.
That's so funny.
I'm kind of hoping for the negative calls now. They're a lot more fun. James, Calgary. Yes, sir. How are you?
I'm sure we'll get it.
Yes, sir.
Hey, Jay.
Yes, sir.
First, I think you're fucking awesome. I can't believe, like, that you're not on Howard 101 way more often.
Mm-hmm. Where's this going? This is none of this. Listen, you know what? I'm
slowly
like
slowly I turn.
I'm like a wounded woman. I've been hurt so many times today. I can't, listen.
You know how it feels now,
James. I can't even trust you, okay, James?
No, I'm serious. But I want to know. Madison keeps saying she's attracted to hot guys over, you know, looks and all that. And
no, I didn't say that. I said
she's actually the opposite. She'll go for a personality
rather than personality. But initially, I look at the guy and I'm like obsessed. Like if he has one bad tooth, but he's incredible, I have to. I can't be with him.
But is Jake? Have you ever been attracted to Jake? He's so funny.
Yes.
Me? Oh.
Actually, my sister asked me a couple months ago, she's like, why don't you and Jay get together? I'm like, he's married with
But
kids.
I have to tell you, can I be honest?
Yeah.
I wouldn't touch you with a pole.
Thank you.
Because you would be attached and want to get together and talk on the phone and, no.
Garrett's nodding.
No, you know what?
Matt,
You know what I've learned in my life?
I think I'm a pretty good girlfriend.
I really can see who you shouldn't screw.
Thanks.
But let me just say this.
Some people that will screw you, but you shouldn't do it. And I think there's a large percentage of guys that know it going in, but they do it anyway. And the next thing you know, they're stuck with like a complete nut.
But let me tell you where Madison. Let me tell you why I disagree and why I think you would. Why I would, if I was in a position, I'd bang the shit out of Madison.
Thank
I'll tell you.
You
why.
Why?
Because she's the type of broad that I can tell and go right. Look, I don't want a relationship.
No,
I don't want. Oh, absolutely.
No,
I know
you
for
could.
A fact.
You could.
I know
you
for
could.
A fact. That she would be okay with this. Just say, hey, every now and then, we're going to get together. We're going to have some fun. We're going
to
fuck around.
Because he knows a couple guys here that I used to do that to.
That's right. And she was cool with it.
One of them I did get attached to.
All right. It's a risky take.
You know what I would hear? Watch this.
But if you're honest in the beginning.
Wait a second. Watch this.
In
ready?
The beginning.
Right.
Madison and I screw each other, and about 6 months passes, and this is what I hear. I've got the knife to my wrist.
I'm going to do it, Jay.
I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it.
And I'm going to scream your name when I call CNN.
You know, I will tell you that
I'm not
in the position to do it now, but I do remember going into a place and going, man, you know what? This is going to be trouble, but it's going to be wild.
Mm-hmm. Because you got that vibe
like
that you
Cindy
get from Madison.
Cindy McCready.
She's fun and dirty.
Cindy McCready was screwing Roger Clemens.
Right.
Crazier than batshit.
Sure.
Screw it. Now she's trying to kill
crazy
herself.
Crazy chicks are hot in the sack.
That's exactly right.
Are you kidding me?
Every time she does anything, tries to kill herself,
the more issues,
says something,
the more positions.
Roger Clemens' wife sticks the knife in his back even deeper.
Sure.
And so when you're a guy and you see the nutcase thing going, I'll tell you the best one. This woman comes over years ago and smoking a joint and hanging out and everything else. And she was a friend of mine's daughter. I don't know how it happens, but it happens. A friend of mine's daughter. And she said, do you like the dress I'm wearing?
Ooh.
And I said, yeah. She goes, it's reversible. And she takes the dress off, you know, underwear. And
nothing?
She had underwear, but you know, like a little
thong.
Nothing. No, and puts it on and goes, see? Now you know where that. And I just knew it was nuts, and I knew her dad and the whole deal.
So how many times did you bang her?
You know what? That's the first night I found out that if you go down on a woman who takes a lot of antidepressants, they can't have an orgasm.
It's true.
Hey, so it works the same for women than it does for guys.
Yes, it does.
Wow.
Yeah, it does. Yes,
it's very hard to come when you're on antidepressants.
It's reversible. I'll never forget it as long as I live.
You didn't really go down on her, did you?
I did.
Oh.
For an hour.
Hey, Jay, if Bubba leaves afternoons, would you do afternoons on Howard 101?
Yes.
I haven't the faintest idea. I think if Bubba left Sirius Satellite, it would be one of the greatest tragedies in American radio. Now, this derisive laughter around me is not coming from me.
No, or me.
Let me say it again, clearly and calmly.
Yeah. But would you do it?
If Bubba the Love Sponge were to leave. By the way, if I did do it, I'd call myself Jay the Used Condom. I would go on as Jay the Old Scumbag in the Corner Thomas. That's what I would do.
Sure, we're spermicidal with you.
You know what? To be honest, and I mean this, I'm not just saying it, I don't even absolutely think about it. But if you think the phone calls this morning have been rough, can you imagine if I were to take over? Listen, I went over to Maxim after they threw those idiots out.
Right.
And they're screaming and yelling at me over there. Wherever they put me, it's a firefight.
But they got over it pretty quickly.
Yeah, but it's a firefight.
Yeah.
Well, here's the funny thing about those guys that were listening to Maxim. They're kind of like these two guys. And then there's Covino and Richard.
Dating experts, would you say?
Yeah, yeah, but it's all, and you might have a son like this. They're these handsome, no body fat guys that I have hated my entire life. It doesn't mean they're bad people, but I hate them.
Yeah.
I hate them because they're a small percentage of the population, and they're looked up to, and they're talked to, and they can have a relationship show. They're not big. And Covino and Rich, great looking guys. And I have a son like this.
I'm not attracted to guys like that. They're too pretty.
But
and
they walk
arrogant.
Into a room,
yeah.
And they're halfway there because they're attractive,
yes.
Right? When I first got over there at Maxim, and I think it's mostly guys 18 to like 35. They all sound like date rape drug guys. They want to go into a bar, give somebody a date rape pill, and get it over with, right?
Mm-hmm.
That they talk relationships and all, it's just, bullshit. And then I say to them, as an older guy, I go, if you do meet somebody and you get married, I'll give you some advice, okay? Get married about, if they tell you you got 6 months to live, get married.
If you really hate yourself and
well,
want
here's
to piss
the other
yourself
thing.
Off, get married.
If I were single, you know, here I am in my 50s. I'm single, right? I probably wouldn't be that interested in going out and getting laid anyway. And then you get laid all the time. As soon as you don't care
yeah,
about
you're
something,
right. You're absolutely
it is
right.
Unbelievable.
Every time I have my mind off of meeting, and I meet a
Boom.
Lot of guys, and
yeah.
I do hook up
right.
kind of frequently with somebody.
Right.
Slut.
No.
I'm sorry.
No, I make out in a closet something.
Right.
When I'm not thinking about it, when I'm just doing my thing and hanging with my friends, I meet a guy because right. I'm just being myself.
Well, Rich,
that's
Boston.
Like,
yes, sir.
Yeah,
go ahead. Richard Boston. Yes, sir. Go ahead.
How you doing, guys?
Good.
I just want to ask Madison, do you still have that Hooters outfit?
I do.
You do? I'd love to see some pictures of it. I promise I'll rub one out to him.
I will post them on jthomas.com.
Now, what is your life like? You're calling up the radio and you want to rub one out to a Hooters. I did say, you know what? Last night I was talking
about. Well, not just any Hooters.
Jay, I could
Madison
just send him the
outfit.
Actual shorts.
Mm-hmm.
I have them in my drawer.
You should put those up for auction on the
Why
site.
Why not?
You know what?
I got a guy. He has a website.
With a period stain,
listen to this.
Maybe?
Listen
oh,
to
no.
this.
Why
Jay,
do you do that?
Jay, listen to this.
Jesus.
I got a guy.
Why do you do that?
He's got a website where he specializes in selling women's panties that have been worn.
Oh, yeah.
That the guy, and
okay.
the guy makes a ton of money. You can
okay.
make a lot of money
okay.
off of that.
Okay.
I'm serious.
We have tried everything on the website.
I think
show.
I might get in trouble.
JThomas.com is an abject failure when it comes to sales.
Should I try to sell my Hooter shorts?
Yes, at JThomas.com.
Okay.
Will you? Okay.
Yeah,
and then
not?
We'll work on a side deal for your pants.
And
your
try and
pants.
Pay the $1,200 I owe from the hot cocktails last night. By the way, was the food any good over there at the Caroline's?
Yeah,
it was good.
Decent, you know.
Okay. I didn't see anybody
I took
eating.
A shit the size of Kentucky. I'm kidding. That was
you know,
your joke.
I wonder
last
if that
night.
Guy's.
No, Vermont, I said.
Oh, no. You said Kentucky.
No, I didn't. I said Vermont.
Oh, you're right. Okay.
Yeah, the Great Northwest. When you have that Harry and David
no,
cheese.
No one can shit the size of Kentucky.
You
what
know.
Are you crazy?
Sorry.
And then you have the eggnog, and then the little drummer boy comes out of your
I
ass.
I love right. the Harry and David reference because you asked me about it the other day.
I didn't know
I
if everybody knew about
that.
It. Okay. Stay where you are. You may win $5,000 for an erotic film. This Darren Roberts guy says go to popporn.com or avnfilmfest.com.
Oh, pop porn.
Pop porn. But the thing is, it's like Playboy Channel sex, right?
Softcore. It's you win $5,000 for making an erotic video
no,
with no erotic.
No, it's $4,000. Second place, $1,000. That's where I made the mistake. It's a $5,000 total. Third place is you get VIP tickets to the Adult Movie Awards.
Fourth place, you get to watch everybody jerk off to your video.
All right. It's the Jay Thomas Show. That's Shuley, and it's Madison. It's Howard 101. Ira the Weatherman, ladies and gentlemen. It's our big holiday show.
Bum, 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 bum. Jingle bell, jingle bell, jingle bell, we're hot.
Say it, Ira.
Jingle bells swing and jingle bells ring.
The snow is coming.
Snowing and blowing up bushels of fun.
Sing it, Shuley.
Now the table has just begun.
Jingle bell, 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 jingle bell
Hi, this is Jay Thomas. Wishing all of you a happy and holy holiday.
Jingle bell time, it's a swell time.
Come on!
To go riding down a one-horse sleigh.
Yeah.
Giddy up, ham it up, bob it up.
There we go.
Jingle bells
down. I'm a wreck.
Yeah.
What?
And a mingle in the jingle and feet.
This on?
Yeah. I resent a bonus. That's a jingle bell.
Yeah, all right.
That's
my jingle, jingle bell rock. Jingle bell, song is a lot longer than I remember.
Yeah. Jingle bell,
all right, that's enough of the jingle
now
bell.
Now just the pretty girls.
All right. Afraid Cousin Brucey may come in. For the holidays, he's releasing his hair into the wild.
Oh.
Sorry. I'm sorry. That's inside information. Somebody yelp. Somebody yell, Paul! Oh, shit.
Jay, does he still have his wings?
Ira.
Hey, I'm Mr. Subtle.
Ira, what I said was kind of...
Did you see George Bush dodging the shoe?
Did you see George Bush dodge that shoe?
Yes.
You know why he was so quick?
Why?
He uses fast acting to act it.
Jay, it's getting worse.
What is?
What is jokes?
This whole city is getting worse.
It is.
Wow, they talk to us about
that. They want to cut jobs, city jobs.
Yeah.
They want to cut fire department. Want the fire department to close.
That's right.
At 9 o'clock. At 12 o'clock.
Well, you better not have a fire after 12 o'clock at night.
It's 9 cooking. O'clock in the morning.
Oh, well, then, wow. Ira, look, Ira, so what? So don't have a fire from midnight to 9, so what?
Now I can't guarantee that. Now, let's say, God forbid, if there's a big fire.
Right.
And it takes them 25 minutes to get there.
It's not going to happen.
He's
going to
spill the coffee. He's so upset he's going to spill that coffee.
Odds are it won't be. By the time they get there, it won't be on fire
anymore.
Our
next guest is waiting. Darren Roberts from popporn.com.
Oh, my God. He had to hear that whole jingle bell crap?
Yes, he did.
I love porn.
Are the 2009 AVN Erotic Film Festival. Go to avnfilmfest.com. Darren Roberts, welcome to the Jay Thomas Show at Howard 101. Shuley and Madison are here. And, of course, the famous weatherman, Ira. Yes, sir. How are you, Darren?
Good morning. Fine, thank you.
Good. Now, you are offering a first prize of $4,000, second prize of $1,000, and a third prize of tickets to the Adult Movie Awards in Vegas. What do people have to do to get their hands on this money?
Well, with all the new tube sites that are out there, we thought we'd be a little bit different and try to challenge people in their creativity and let them do something erotic and at the same time put it up there, maybe make some cash. We're also giving them a film contract with one of the top companies over here in L.A. to give a shot at producing their first adult movie. So, you know, we're really playing off of people's, you know, creativity with their cameras in their homes and seeing what they come up with.
Now, there is online voting began in November already. It's already, and do you already have all of the submissions, or can people still submit?
No, out of the gate, we had a great deal of interest, but a lot of people are now, I would say, in their process. We get a lot of questions, and our national campaign for this begins January 1st. So, we expect probably by the end of January for there to be a few thousand submissions on this, and then there's actually two processes. We have an online voting system where users can also go in and rate the clips, and then the best rated clips we're putting in front of we do the AVN Awards every year, and so we're taking a panel of our judges, and then we're going to narrow those down to the top three.
Now here's the crazy part. You don't want any explicit sex in this erotic film, and that seems unusual to me.
Well, I mean, shooting erotic sex is pretty, you know, the act of sex is pretty easy to do.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's a little bit more difficult to take and have the challenge of not being able to show that, but yet still having to produce something that, you know, is erotic and provokes feelings. So we thought we'd be a little bit more challenging. And also it allows us, you know, obviously a little bit greater viewing if we could keep it, you know, an R-rated content. I don't think you need to show the act of sex for something to be erotic.
So basically, you want people to make a video of everything we fast forward through to get to the sex when they're watching porn.
I personally am more turned on by the silhouette of the breast and maybe the pumping.
Really?
You know, I don't need to see the actual penis going.
Right.
Yeah, and you know, it's a little bit more challenging.
It's hotter. It's hotter, definitely. Yeah, and, sexy. And, you know,
I'll take somebody getting penetrated by a table leg over a silhouette any day of the week.
You don't like just seeing like a round ass, Shuli, and then like the tits? Like, that turns me on. Yeah, I might be a lesbian, but this, you know, that turns me on.
You know, I kind of do agree a bit with Shuli, and I'm going to have to ask you this.
You really, you like to see the
you fast forward to oral sex with the guy looking down on the woman.
But it goes on for like 30 minutes, and all she does is suck, suck, sucky, suck, 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 suck.
That's called doing a good job, Madison.
Darren, she's beginning to sound like a wife.
I just think it's more erotic and sexier.
So here's the thing. You want people to submit something incredibly sexy, and here are the rules. Close-up shots of the vagina, penis, and anus will not be permitted, right?
Right.
You can't have insertion. You can't see the stuff.
I was going to do a whole 3D thing.
Do you allow no bestiality, right?
Of course, nothing.
No sadomasochism. Right. And all the actors have to be adults. Are you making them hold up their birth certificate to the camera?
Newspaper with the date on it?
Yeah. How do you do that?
We have them send in. There's a document that they fill out, and they send in verifying their age, and then we check that out on our end.
All right, and so you're getting thousands of entries, or you're waiting, or what?
Well, we have a few thousand people that have emailed us, you know, with questions on the guidelines, you know, that are either submitting content, questions on submitting content. It's really been up now for a couple of weeks, and again, the real push, you know, that we're making starts this week, and really our national campaign start the 1st of January. So. We don't, you know, we kind of soft launched it, put it out there, and made sure that we had the interest before we spend the budget on, you know, we're doing advertising all the local papers nationally, as far as, you know, that there's a erotic film festival, and, you know, you can make
money. That's real. The erotic film festival are the real stars of erotic films, and there's anuses and entry and the whole thing, right?
Yeah, well, we have an adult, you know, we have an adult award show, the ADN Awards. Right. Real films, and I mean it's a great full process. So
chicks are up there accepting award for best group orgy, you know, fuckhole, and they're crying, thanking their mother.
Right,
it's true.
It's
awesome.
No, Darren, you're a handsome guy. Were you in the porno industry yourself? I mean, were you an actor?
No, I wasn't.
Gorgeous.
I'm in the industry. I wasn't an actor though.
Now, when you're on the set, and have you produced the erotic films?
No.
Oh. You've worked for the companies?
Just
root them on?
Here's what's, you know, if you go over there and I've watched one porno being shot. It was very professional, and I remember a girl got something in her eye and they yelled cut.
They always do.
Yeah. It wasn't all that sexy. But if you work in that industry and thousands of women want to get into it. So the audition process has got to be the girl takes her clothes off. And does something with the director. It's probably the only time when not only would it be allowed, it would almost have to be mandatory. Yeah, it'd be mandatory to have to get laid during the audition process. What is that like when they audition the fresh newcomer?
It's different across the board. Yes, there are situations that the interview process is just that. They come in, you ask a couple of questions, take off your clothes, take a couple of pictures. Mm-hmm. But, you know, also we have corporations now involved in this business that, you know, it's
so you have to screw the entire board of directors. The entire board of directors must be screwed.
You know, now there's nine of them instead of one. The process is a little more sterile. I mean, they certainly take off their clothes, get some pictures. But, you know, I certainly don't think the business today is quite like it was, say, 10 years ago. you know, it's the entry process. I mean, the girls that come in the business all want to work for the big companies. That's their goal.
Vivid.
So, yeah, they want to work for, you know, for the top companies that are going to get them out there. And, you know, the process in interviewing with those companies is just a little bit different. I mean,
do they ever think that after a few years of just getting, you know, banged immersively on camera, and I know they make money and everything else, but they don't think they're going to get into real acting and stuff. But I guess they do. I don't, what's odd to me is it seems like there's gotta be a lot of attrition and there's so many women trying to get into it. And I mean, is there like a pension fund or something? Cause they're gonna be vilified and made fun of unless they become Jenna
Jameson.
The old
Jameson. NFL players can't get taken care of.
Yeah.
But they have a, they
yeah,
have
what
a
happens
program.
to the older porn stars?
Is there an old porn home they
yeah,
go
do they
to?
Help them any at all? I mean,
There are organizations, but none of them are big, and you're absolutely right. I mean, the attrition rate is, you know, for this is huge.
You're just you're not even old. You're 35.
They just have to save their money.
They have to save their money. And, you know, there have been some smart ones. I mean, certainly they come into the business, you know, work, you know, for a few years, put it all away, don't spend it, and then they retire and you know, get married and live their life.
And how hard is it to grasp? Like, all right, if you had to take two cocks in your ass at the same time for $5,000, you know what? I'm not going to go out and buy a TV with it right away. You know, that's money I'm going to save because that hurt.
You have to
that's a hard day at work.
You gotta learn how to budget.
Yeah.
Okay. Darren Roberts is here. Go to popporn.com, avnfilmfest.com, and he's asking for an erotic film that has no insertion.
Can there be mutual masturbation? Like, what? Now I'm trying to figure out what the hell can be in this video.
Yes. We can. There could be masturbation. There can be.
But no.
No. Like, we're not showing anything up close. It's anything that you would see, you know, that you watch on you know, your cable box.
You should do like a Calvin Klein.
Without the hardcore, you know, channel.
So no licking of a titty.
Yeah. You know, we could show licking of a titty, but we won't show, you know, licking of a pussy. Up close.
Whoa. Mm.
Now, are you married to a porn star or a former porn actress?
I was once upon a time. I've been divorced for
all right. Hold
years
on.
Now.
When we come back, may I just ask you a couple of questions about that?
Sure.
When we come back, because it is always interesting to me to be watching a pornographic film and you see that either the guy is married, it's like they forgot to take their ring off or whatever, or the woman has a big diamond on and stuff. And I'm watching it going, what was it like to be married, to the woman? It's the Jay Thomas Show. Darren Roberts is here. He is the CEO of the AVN, the Erotic Film Fest. And if you want to, put your entry in or find out the rules. Pretty simple. Go to avnfilmfest.com or popporn.com, and we will be back.
The Jay Thomas Show
on Howard 101.
You like a rock star.
Hi, I'm Jay Thomas, and Julie is here, and Madison is here, and Ira the Weatherman is here. We'll go back to Darren Roberts from go to avnfilmfest.com and talk about the chance for you to win the $4,000 for it. Ira the Weatherman, you've been listening to Opie and Anthony lately?
No, I haven't. They're horrible. And everybody in the Seven Seas
restaurant,
they all send their regards.
Well, thank you.
Do they really?
Are they listening right now?
Yes, they are.
What do they do when we curse? When we say, you know, like Madison was talking about an English guy with a smelly penis.
They still love your show.
They do.
Very, very much.
Do they serve any, like a smelly penis with broccoli?
They have a lovely fist soup.
No, they don't.
You always do the fist.
Yes!
You said fist.
Yes!
Hey, Darren Roberts, welcome back to the show. Thank you. Now, you married a porn star. You're a really handsome guy. You're a businessman. You're a smart man. I could have told you before you married her that you would get divorced.
Yeah.
I mean, you know what? There was an actor that I knew that married a porn star, and she had a kid and the whole thing, and we used to say to him, you know, you're making a mistake, and, you know, and he married her, and it was a mistake.
But it's something we all have to do once.
But, I mean, how did you, in your head, I know she's doing it for work and it makes it meaningless. How did you get it in your head when she was having sex with other men and women? It didn't bother you in the least?
Well, no, it actually bothered me. When I met her, she was no longer doing that, and she had gone to work for one of the companies as a sales rep. And actually, she didn't tell me what she did until about 6 months into the relationship. So,
what was her?
It was kind of the shock factor with, you know, response of, you know, this is going to be challenging, and you know, I guess I'll try moving on. And you know, we moved on with it, and we were together for.
But were you in the business already?
No, I was in a non-related advertising. I had to come with a few companies of my own.
Mm-hmm.
And
did you go back and look? Did you go? Did your curiosity drive you to get some of her old films?
You know, it had over the years, but actually, still to this day, I haven't seen any of them, and you know, I don't really think about it. We've been, you know, we're good friends. We've been divorced for over about 10 years now. So.
Okay.
What did she go by when she did porn? What was her?
She would kill me because they don't produce those movies anymore.
Okay.
I can't say all right. That.
Did you have kids?
Yes, we did.
And so, how does she explain to her kids? I mean, you're in the business, and you can say, "Yeah, it's a business. Forget about it." But how does she explain, you know, that she was, you know, in these pornos to the daughter or your son or whatever you have? Is that difficult?
You know, it is, and we really haven't. It's something that was long done before they were here, and, mm-hmm. and a new career, and you know, we haven't really crossed that bridge, and you know, she's not. It was a short time in her life that, you know, she did some things, and you know, when she's ready to make that call and have that discussion, then you know, that ball's kind of in her court to do that.
All right, okay. Well, Darren, thank you. And go to avnfilmfest.com and make an erotic film, and maybe if somebody wins that heard you on the show here, or you let them in, we'll have you back. When are you having them in? When are you having the like have some together, like in the spring or something?
Yeah, we'll have the finals probably in May, and
right.
we
should do a video.
We might do an erotic video right here where everybody just has a Sirius Satellite XM sweater on and nothing else. Okay, thank you, Darren Roberts. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, Shuley Madison. I'll say goodbye and then keep seeing you. It just never stops.
It's great having you in town, Jay.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. Okay.
Great to see you, Jay.
Thank you, Ira, Garrett Andrews, and Sean Kelly, and Art Sears.
And Caroline's wants to do it again.
We'll do it again.
Yeah.
Thank you, Howard. It's Howard 101. All right.